Good evening and welcome to episode 11 of Tomorrow's World Audit Time. Good evening, Mark.
Hello, Russell. How are you?
Well, I'll tell you what, Mark. I've been paying maximum respects today. I've been lesting to forget all day, lesting left, right and centre, because today is the 11th of the 11th, so it's Armistice Day, and we're recording our 11th episode on the 11th of the 11th. But I mean, there's absolutely no connection with Armistice Day today. It'd be probably a bit tasteless to do anything in connection with it. But also, I was going to also say that they don't sell poppies over here.
No.
But they do sell heroin, which is, of course, ground up poppies. I've got a big bag of that, and we'll be shooting up on, with it, periodically through the show. So I hope you're looking forward to that.
How very Dutch of you, as well,
Dave. Yeah. Speaking of shooting things up, James Bond. So No Time to Die is riding high at the, well, riding medium at the box office at the moment. We've caught it a little bit late. So what better time to do a James Bond special? It's a James Bond special of Tomorrow's World, released in time for The World Is Not Enough. Any thoughts on The World Is Not Enough, Mark?
Do I have any thoughts? Does anyone have any thoughts on The World Is Not Enough? It was, if you'd asked me, before I'd seen this episode, if you'd asked me what I remember of The World Is Not Enough, I probably would have drawn a blank. Now that I've seen this episode and I've seen some clips, what I remember of The World Is Not Enough are the clips I've seen from this episode, Russ. And even that, I don't really remember what happens in it at all.
No.
It is the one with the beginning where he's on the boat and he ends up kind of boating along to the Millennium. I'm not really, that's not really selling it properly. Boating along to the Millennium Dome. But other than that, I have no idea what happens in it.
No.
That's not the one with the, is it the one with the newspaper baron?
No, see, now this is the thing, Mark.
Yeah.
These are the two most commonly confused James Bond films, I reckon. I reckon nobody can remember the difference between Tomorrow Never Dies and The World Is Not Enough. Not even a James Bond aficionado could tell the difference between the two of them. But this is not the one with the newspaper baron. This is the one...
That's Tomorrow Never Dies,
is the one with Robert Carlyle in it.
And I've even seen him in one of the clips and I completely blanked on it.
I think it's got something to do with an oil pipeline, maybe? I think it's an oil pipeline, but I can't remember. And it turns out that actually Sophie Marceau is really the baddie.
Spoiler alert, because literally if I'd sat down and watched it, I'm sure that would have been a complete surprise to me. And then I'd have forgotten it again, waiting for the next time I'd seen it.
Yeah.
No, I was going to say, this I don't really have terribly fond memories of James Bond from this time. I have a cousin, Keen, who I think listens, and he's a big Pierce Brosnan fan, but then he is slightly younger than this. And I don't know, I just, even watching some of the clips, Pierce Brosnan, God, he was charismatic. He was kind of a fun amalgam of like Roger Moore and Sean Connery. But then you just look at some of the dreck he was forced to act in, and it was just like, what a hospital pass he was given, really. No wonder they had to burn the whole thing down and rebuild.
I still prefer him to Daniel Craig, even though his films aren't of as good quality. I think he makes a better Bond, but I'll get to that later about what I think is making.
Yeah,
we can
we'll touch
Bond
that later. Yeah.
But I think the memorable thing about it, the one memorable thing about this film, and it's possible that they reverse engineered the entire film from this, is that Denise Richards plays a character called Dr. Christmas Jones.
Dr. Christmas Jones. And
then,
pathetic.
And then the last line of the film is, I thought Christmas only came once a year, which is, I think, a good hark back to the classics of Roger Moore. I think his attention re-entry, sir, and just keeping the British end up, sir. They're the two best ones previously. But Daniel Craig doesn't do that anymore.
No, he doesn't. Thank God. The one thing I'd say about the Roger Moore, they always felt, like, as cheesy as they were, they always felt like they kind of naturally came from the circumstance he was in, where it's like you feel the scaffolding around that end line. You know, you can sense the engineering that went in to make it happen so they could bail out with this. And I still don't think it... I think it's just unnecessarily crass, Russ.
Yeah. Well, there won't be any unnecessary crassness in this episode.
Only entirely necessary crassness.
But, this is an episode from the Peter Snow, Philippa Forrester presented era. So, 17th of November 1999. So they started doing it on the 3rd of September 1997. It was following a big revamp of the programme. So after Howard rode off into the sunset, they promoted Philippa to a main presenter and brought in Peter Snow as a new presenter. And they gave them all like a brand new studio, very different to the old studio. It's I've looked at it. It's got a gantry in it, Mark. It's got loads of really awful furniture in it. I mean, it ticks a lot of boxes, but unfortunately, this particular episode that we're watching is not broadcast from the studio at all, is it? It's all on location. Yeah. So it's all on basically things connected to James Bond locations. All of the technology is ostensibly connected to James Bond in some very tenuous way in places. So So Stone Forrester carried on like presenting together all the way until 2001. The summer 2001 is when they both retired from the role. And then, obviously, presumably, that's when the real...
the golden age, Roswell, then.
Yeah, the real decline. Because real decline happened after that, I think. Because I think that this is still pretty decent Tomorrow's World. I think it's still... It's pretty much still the same format that we all expect, and the same sort of some good inventions, some crap inventions... all put together quite well.
It's a special episode, and obviously it's in service of the release of a James Bond film that comes out the following week. But there are definitely segments in this that would fit into any Tomorrow's World episode, any good Tomorrow's World episode that we've seen, in the terms of, like, you actually, you know, they introduce you to something. And I mean, especially one of them, I think, time if we'd watched this, it would have been a real introduction to the advancement of a technology we might all be familiar with, which has now gone on to kind of accelerate its development. And with the exception of a few lines in it that relate back to the James Bond brief, I mean, there's a lot in this that's still really enjoyable, still really well presented, specifically from Philippa, who has her natural charm and charisma and interest with all the people she speaks to. I kind of feared the worst, and I was really pleased that this was a mostly decent episode.
We talk about product placement, don't we, Mark? BBC's rules on product placement, and how they are, in many episodes, really try to hide brand names and things like that. So how are they allowed to advertise a film for half an hour on primetime BBC One? How does that fit in with their product placement? It seems like there's one rule for the creative industries and another for everyone else. Is that what it is?
I think that's a really great theory. The idea that the creative industries, that they're very much a part of that. They're part of the BBC, they're part of entertainment, they're part of broadcasting. They all travel in the same circles. It's not grubby capitalism. It's not some horrible, you know, Italian sportswear company trying to sell you sports socks. No, I think you're absolutely right. I think there really does seem to be two distinct approaches to advertising in the BBC. I suppose you might argue one is a product and one isn't. And maybe James Bond is not seen as a product. It possibly also fits more into, James Bond is maybe, you know, a part of the culture.
Yeah.
You know, he's a national treasure. So it's a very different thing to... Well, I mean, they don't mention BMW later on.
No, they don't.
Which obviously was the car... Yeah. They don't mention the logo. Pierce Brosnan around this time is driving BMWs in this film, which I remember being a real scandal at the time.
Yeah.
And actually, when you look back at it, it's like, yeah, no, it doesn't really. Anyway,
he drives a Toyota in the 90s in You Only Live Twice, so it's not like he's always driven an Aston Martin. So
I suppose, but again, I suppose they felt a bit too much like product placement, actually, ironically enough. I suppose that's probably why people are again it. So they don't mention BMW, but they do show the BMW logo on a couple of occasions as well. No, it's interesting. I think you're onto something there. Yeah. It does feel like there's one rule for one thing and another rule for something else.
Because if I bring out a CD, obviously nobody brings out CDs these days or whatever it is they bring out, mini disc or whatever, or I bring out my latest novel, I can stroll straight onto Graham Norton or whatever and advertise it. If I brought out a new type of drink or can of beans, I would never be allowed on there to talk about it. It just seems like a massive double standard to me. And what it smacks of, Mark, is elite media bubble. That's what it is.
Yeah.
It's a conspiracy against the creators of things.
So someone desperate to get inside that bubble as quick as possible.
Well, it looks fun. Yeah, looks fun in there.
It does. I know. You're frustrated by your bubble adjacency and you really want to get in. But the thing is, Russ, if you enter it, you're going to pop it and then no one's going to be happy. Who popped the bubble? Oh, Russell.
I was also wondering, do you think this is the only James Bond Tomorrow's World special they've done? Because, I mean, James Bond films come out every other year or so. Just wonder whether there are any previous ones.
I was wondering that as well. I deliberately haven't looked. I imagine there must be... There must be another one. Mm. There has to be. If not like two or three, certainly one. But like, can you imagine them not doing a James Bond special for maybe The Living Daylights?
I don't know.
Maybe more, maybe more so than the 60s and 70s. I just think...
I don't think, yeah.
That probably would have been slightly beneath the BBC at the time, whereas in the 80s, it's not that it was beneath or above. It's more like it would just be much more acceptable to base a programme around something like that. Yeah, I wouldn't. It wouldn't shock me.
And they might even have done one for Tomorrow Never Dies. And then, they've got Tomorrow Never Dies. The world is not enough. Tomorrow's world. Mm. See what I did there, Mark?
Tomorrow World.
Close, though, isn't it?
Tomorrow World, yeah.
The only James Bond films with the word tomorrow or world in them.
So you think it's coincidence? So you're saying it's not coincidence?
Oh, they're not coincidence. I'm going to see if I can find out if there was a special when Tomorrow Never Dies come out.
You're going to do it right now?
No, I can't be bothered. I mean, given that, when did Tomorrow Never Dies come out? Was it 97?
That sounds right. I didn't look it up, but I feel like it was 95, 97, 99.
So it'd be these two again. So probably not. I doubt these two would have.
No. Oh, yeah. No, Philip and Peter.
No, because I just like the idea of, you know, Howard Stapleford on a jetpack or with one of those shoes with a knife in it. Something like that.
Maybe Goldeneye. Maybe 95.
But Tomorrow's World hasn't got the word golden in it, so no, I don't know. Doesn't match my theory, Mark.
Oh, sorry, Russell. In that case, no, definitely not. This is the only two, obviously, and they definitely did one 2 years ago with the same presenters.
And also, I just wanted to say, if anyone out there really doesn't like James Bond, we're not actually going to talk about it very much in this program because there's already about 10,000 James Bond podcasts out there, and they've probably done everything better than us. So I'll make sure to only bring it up if it's relevant to whatever it is we're talking about. So
I've got a couple of observations, but we're here to talk about Tomorrow's
exactly.
World.
Exactly. Yeah.
Happily.
So should we start talking about Tomorrow's World?
Let's do it, Russ.
Welcome to the future of James Bond. Tonight, the hardware 007 would kill to get his hands on. And I don't mean just old props like this. We're going to be testing the real thing.
And we've got our own mission to accomplish in this James Bond special, to get inside and show you the most secret room in Britain. Along the way, the ultimate in Bond-style flying machines, a real backpack helicopter.
Plus, the latest in high-tech camouflage. Can it help Jez Nelson disappear?
And shaken or stirred, we glimpse the future of the perfect martini.
Blimey, Mark, this must have been your hardest working rundown of the credits you've ever undertaken. It was an absolute relentless barrage of imagery. I felt like I was undergoing some sort of visual torture. What?
I've had to come up with a new, brand new special technique, Russ, so that I can do these segments justice. It seems really short because so much happens and it's so quick. It seems really quick and short. It's not, and it's full of nonsense. So we have a brand new to us opening credits and opening theme tune. We can talk about the credits first because I've made a very long list, as you've seen. And as everyone's about to hear, it starts off with we see Nirvana Baby again. We saw in episode 4, I think it was, when we watched the episode of 1996. And so we talked about how there's a baby, not, you know, filmed underwater, floating around like the Nirvana album track. Same footage, but they've messed around with the contrast. So he looks incredibly sinister. Or she. And it's longer footage. Like, believe it or not, Russ, I stopped and compared the amount of footage used in 1996 and in 1999. And we actually see more this time.
Right.
And I can see why they cut it out last time, because as the camera gets closer to the baby, it has a really sinister, smug grin. I don't know. But this baby's different, because actually, I should say, the footage starts off. I got really excited. The footage starts off, but we see this kind of glowing globe of blue gas, and then we zoom in, and inside that glowing globe, Russ, of blue glass, of gas, is the Nirvana baby, of which there is extra footage, and it ends up looking sinister and smug. This kind of fades, and in front of us now is a 3D landscape, which I would describe as being slightly barren. I hope everyone at home, please cover your eyes.
Okay.
Just listen to the words and stop picturing what I'm saying.
Okay. I mean, can I just, before you even start describing things, reiterate that apart from the Nirvana baby, everything in this is horrific CGI.
Yeah, except for the presenters.
So when you're imagining these images, imagine them flying out of a crap computer.
Yeah, I mean, think Lawnmower Man, but worse. Another Pierce Brosnan film. So yeah, this is very poorly rendered 3D visuals here. So again, close your eyes. Let's take a break. Let's take a breath. So we are flying over a slightly barren grassland with a river running through it. It's like we're in a helicopter. We see an astronaut trapped, unmoving, in one of those kind of, I don't know what they're called, but one of those kind of gyroscopic things that you used to have at like the Trocadero Center in fun fairs, where you kind of hold the handlebars and you'd be swung around in multiple different directions. But it also kind of reminded me of the vehicle transportation device from Contact. So this astronaut is trapped in this, unmoving, literally unmoving, doesn't move a muscle. And as we get closer, we zoom by him. And then the landscape below becomes greener, and a glider swoops in and banks left past a solitary tree, Russ. I don't know what this means. We can talk about this in great detail. I don't know what it means. But we're now moving, we're accelerating faster and faster, but not as fast as the glider, Russell, because that disappears off to the left, way ahead of us. And then, bizarrely, a kind of purple/ultraviolet spectrum coloured parrot flies across the screen. And as it finishes flying past, we see Philippa Forrester ahead of us in the distance. But based on, and I did the maths here, based on the tree we saw the glider fly over, Philippa can only be described as a giantess. She must be, I don't know, 12, 14 stories tall.
I guarantee there's specialist websites for that.
As we get closer to us, as she gets closer to us, or we get closer to her, she pivots. It's like she's rotating in a little turntable. She pivots clockwise, and she reveals in her hands what starts off as two, again, poorly rendered balls. They sort of meld into an egg timer shape, but continue to make the shape of one giant poorly rendered ball. And we carried on. Oh, I should point out, actually, that while she's been pivoting and we've been flying towards her, lots of giant flower blossoms have been growing and dying around here. And I don't know, how long is it on the screen for? Half a second. An appallingly rendered floating flying car just flies off, flies over here at a really bizarre angle.
Can I just say, Mark, out of all of these things that you've now mentioned, I only remember the glider, Philippa Forrester, and the flowers. I don't recognise
the rest is all
thing that you're saying. It moves that quickly.
It's so quick, yeah. I mean, obviously, I'm going to try and drag it out as long as possible, but to be directly proportional to how quick all these things are on screen. As Philippa zooms by, Peter Snow solidifies the distance. He wasn't there before. He just kind of appears like he's been transported from the Enterprise. And he stares at us, then his hand, emotionless, at three purple spheres. And as the camera goes by, his face doesn't move. It's this kind of rictus grin and these dead, bland eyes. And then behind Peter, because we fly by him, appearing as Peter did, so kind of fading in, we see another man, and this man is walking and he's in a suit, but he phases in and out of vision to be replaced by his own skeleton, which then gets hidden by his skin and then the skeleton and then so on and so forth. And then it should be noted that in Philippa's absence, Russ, the green of the ground has faded again. And we're once again in a barren grassland. I don't know what that means, Russell, but there's probably websites devoted to it. And then finally, the camera pans up and once again, we're confronted by the Nirvana baby in his gas globe. Oh, actually, I've missed some details out here. Sorry, behind the man who turns into a skeleton, there are three satellite dishes. And a school of five black and white striped fish sort of swim around him.
Oh, he's about
but they're on screen for him. But they're always, they're on screen for a fraction of a second, which is why I kind of almost ignored it. Anyway, the camera pans up, and once again, it's the Nirvana baby in his gas globe. The only question I wonder is, like, has this been his dream all along? We started with him, we finished with her. We started with her, we finished with him. We don't know the gender of the baby.
Well, do we know the gender of the baby, Mark? Because I sent you a link today to...
I don't know if we do.
To a Twitter...
Can we talk about it?
Yeah. Twitter thread, which was quite interesting. So Spencer Kelly, who's always... Who presents the hideous bastard child of tomorrow's world, Click on BBC on BBC News Channel, which I absolutely hate. But he posted a few years back on Twitter that he always wanted to be a Tomorrow's World presenter, and thankfully Tomorrow's World is not around for him to present it. And then somebody below him in the thread said, I wonder what happened to that baby in the opening sequence. And then tagged a few of the old presenters, including Howard. And then Howard replies to the thread saying, oh, we met her at the... She turned up for the 30th anniversary special. She's a very attractive young lady these days, or in those when we saw her, which raises a huge number of questions. Well, it answers the question that A, the baby must be a girl, but mm-hmm. B, the 30th anniversary of Tomorrow's World would have been in 1995. Mm-hmm. This baby was clearly filmed in the early 90s because that's when this sequence was first created. So the math doesn't work out, Mark. The math doesn't work out. So what is Howard on about?
I don't know. Because when I read it, I didn't even think about the because it made sense to me. It's like, because this is about 30 years ago, 30 years old, this kind of opening. It's not really, it's like 25. But you're right. Let's assume the baby was filmed in, like, I don't know, 92, 93 or something like that. So that child would be almost 30. I thought, oh yeah, that makes sense. Until you realise, of course, that the tweet was sent in 2018 and he was talking about something that happened in the past because he could only barely recollect. And you're absolutely right. I do not know what he's talking about, but he cannot be talking about the Nirvana baby.
No. The other thing about the baby, I thought, Mark, am I stretching it by suggesting that a baby seemingly floating through space in a bubble is reminiscent of the Babel floating through space in the bubble in 2001 A Space Odyssey? What do you reckon?
The Star Child.
The Star Child.
I have to say, obviously we refer to the babies in Nirvana a bit because in the previous episode we described them thusly because it was clearly filmed underwater and has that kind of same effect as the Nirvana album cover. This does feel different. And I think because we end up back at the baby in its globe, I think this is... definitely, it's less of a stretch for us. Mostly because actually it was when I first saw this, when I rewatched it recently, it's like the first thing I thought of was the Star Child, or the Star Baby from 2001.
Yeah.
Yeah, full stop.
Because I actually, little sidetrack, I've got quite an interesting connection between Kubrick and Bond. Do you know about this?
I don't know. I haven't heard it yet.
So obviously, I don't know. I feel like something I might have told you before, but I haven't told the people at home, so I might as well tell you again.
Oh, that's surprised.
So obviously, apart from John Barry doing the music for all for the Bond films, I think the thing that the most, what made Bond films feel like Bond films is the design, the production design. Mm. Like from the very beginning, they were very, very distinctive with these huge, amazing sets and all this. And the man who did them was a man called Ken Adam. He's like one of the most legendary production designers of all time. After he did Dr. No, which was obviously his first Bond film he did, which was the first Bond film, he then worked with Stanley Kubrick on Dr. Strangelove. And he's the one that designed the amazing war room, you know, that huge, that beautiful set in that. Mm. Which apparently Steven Spielberg described as the greatest movie set of all time. And he knows about these things.
I think it's fabulous. Yeah, I think it's amazing.
But so then he became friends with Stanley Kubrick. And then worked on Barry Lyndon, which I have to admit I've never seen because it always looks a bit like it'd be a bit boring. I don't know whether it is. I mean, I've not found any other Kubrick films boring, but it just looks like it might be.
Yeah.
But that was famously only filmed with natural light, and because normally films of the time, probably even now, primarily filmed with studio lighting. That's, you know, illuminating everything from outside of the scene. But in this case, Kubrick wanted to do it with all natural light. So he had to go to NASA and get special lenses, the lenses they used to photograph the dark side of the moon. He got hold of them, and that's so he could film interior scenes by candlelight because they could pick up such things in such darkness that he was able to do it. So Fast forward to The Spy Who Loved Me. Ken Adam is building this massive, huge tanker set. You know that in Spy Love Me, yeah. There's that tanker that swallows submarines.
There's a bit
where Rog breaks them all out the submarines. There's this massive like gunfight inside the tanker. Mm-hmm. Rog carries a bomb across somewhere.
Wasn't that the world's largest set for a very long time?
It may well have been. I don't know. I didn't look into that.
I feel like it was for a very long time.
But Ken Adam, because it was so big, you couldn't really light it with studio. So he designed the set so that it would have its own lighting. So inside the set, there is like this. It's as if the base is lit, is well lit.
I don't know. I'm going to go on a limb here and call it diegetic lighting.
That's the word, diegetic. I was trying to think of it.
Yeah.
But he couldn't quite work out how to get it so it would light it all properly. And then he remembered, my mate Stan is the world's leading cinema expert in natural lighting.
Mm.
Phoned him up. Stan went, okay, I'll come over on a Sunday when there's no one there, just the security guards. He came over on the Sunday. They worked on it all day, fitted the lighting exactly where it should go. So The Spy Who Loved Me, which incidentally is the best James Bond film, is actually partially directed by Stanley Kubrick.
That's incredible. I didn't know that.
And
yeah, that's amazing.
Also, Jaws, the henchman.
Yes.
His Jaws were designed by Stanley Kubrick's stepdaughter, Katerina.
Oh.
Yeah. So there you go.
Uh-huh.
Bond-Kubrick connection.
Connection made.
Yep. Tick.
All right, well, it is a star child. There we go.
Brilliant.
The other thing we should talk about is the new-to-us theme tune.
Yes.
Because I know you have a lot of opinions on it. So I'll start first, because I vividly remember the first time I watched this. I don't know, what do we call this? This era or this generation of Tomorrow's World? I mean, what would be the kind of the descriptor for... period? I don't know.
Epoch.
Yeah, okay. I was thinking epoch, but that sounded a bit too grand. though eon would be more on brand, because we are talking about...
Oh, James Bond,
Yeah, we'll go with epoch. So this epoch of Tomorrow's World, which you said started a couple of years before. 97, wasn't it? Yeah. So I remember sitting down to watch, if not the first episode, then one of the first, and being absolutely flabbergasted by the theme tune, because I'm a fan of the Divine Comedies, you know.
Yeah.
And it is a re-recorded version of a album track of theirs, and it's called In Pursuit of Happiness. It's from the album, a short album about love,
mm-hmm.
which is a really wonderful, beautiful album. Absolutely fabulous. I think it came out in 1997, didn't it? Maybe. And it wasn't a single, this song. So I was genuinely shocked that they had used this.
Yeah.
It's like the kind of the last act of the song. The song is, you know, it's a lovely orchestral piece, but then there is this kind of, it's kind of this aggressive Baroque crescendo, which then gets dropped away at the end for the last two lines of the song.
Yeah.
It's a really epic, fantastic listen. And obviously it's supposed to kind of engender a certain kind of, powerlessness possibly, or certainly maybe dread is too far, but like it's designed to create an emotion. So I was flabbergasted to hear it. Felt seen. Loved the fact that Neil Hannon from the Divine Comedy was earning more money from anything.
Yeah.
But, and it was you writing down the notes as reminding me, it just doesn't work.
Mm.
It just does not work as a Tomorrow's World theme tune. It's not the original version. They have re-recorded it. So they've added elements in that are not present in the original, including a kind of a weird xylophone instrumental bit. But they've also kind of added in bits that kind of have a major chord sound to it. So it does sound a bit more positive and uplifting. But it's kind of discordant against the original beat of the tune, or the original kind of direction of the tune is not entirely positive. It's not negative either. But then to me, it really feels like they've tried to layer over it to kind of make it do what they wanted to do.
Yeah.
And it's just really, if unlike me, you didn't know what it was from, or you didn't know that it was a real thing that they had kind of Jerry built on, I think it'd be really weird and confusing. And I would understand why people would either forget that this was the theme tune for Tomorrow's World for a while, or actively dislike it.
I don't know whether it's the changes they've made it or what. I don't think it's necessarily a bad piece of music. I can imagine it opening up an album and it working perfectly like that.
Absolutely.
However, I genuinely found it anxiety inducing. Like,
yes,
it's. I think it's probably also combined with the images. It's so sort of here comes charging towards, like the music is everything's accelerating towards you, and you've got all this. It, 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 honestly, it feels like you're hurtling towards your demise sort of thing, especially as you've got this passage of time theme going on the...
And skeletons and stuff. And actually, you're absolutely right there. Earlier I described it as like, it's almost like, imagine you're in a helicopter. You're right, it's not that at all. Imagine you're being fired from something.
Yeah,
you have no control over your direction. All you know is that things are passing over you and under you and by you and around you.
What is that thing where a bloke gets fired out of... I can't remember if it was an advert or a music video or what. Where
PlayStation.
Like, oh, was it a PlayStation where he gets fired out?
Yeah, he's born, gets fired out of his mum. He ages in the air. Yeah, I'm pretty sure that it was PlayStation 1 or PlayStation 2. It was definitely one of the two. I was thinking about that the other day, funny enough. Yeah, absolutely right. It's not great. I mean, often you and I will talk about how the theme tune for the episode we're describing is our favourite theme tune. Yeah. And obviously the joke is that everyone is our favourite theme tune. And it's very difficult to get out of your head. With this one, I imagine you probably can't. You probably can't even hum it to yourself right now.
Oh, I can.
Okay, I take it back. You can, Russ. It was like, you know, I've known this song for a long time, but it just doesn't work. It's such a disappointing opening credits. Bearing in mind some of the classics I've described so brilliantly over the episodes. Yeah, it's not a great start. Luckily, like the music they use throughout is basically James Bond music. So
yes, yeah, yeah,
and with a few exceptions.
I think the best music category will be hotly contested this episode. I think maybe John Barry is possibly my favourite film composer. It's either John Barry or John Williams. Either the Johns.
So moving on from the opening credits, because we've talked far too long about that. Hey, edit some of that for content, Russ. As we said earlier, this is not in a studio. This is all filmed on location. The introductory clips, all filmed in and around Whitehall and Westminster. And the other thing that we should point out is that all throughout the episode, they keep on going back to kind of a Blofeld pastiche.
Yes, yeah.
Where somebody is clearly in one of those rooms where it's either an editing suite or it's the control room for like a live broadcast where the director sits and points at camera one, stuff like that. It's very clearly within the television center. And what we see is we see a man sat down pressing buttons by screens, stroking a real cat who does try and get away at one point. And you don't see their head or anything like that. I warn you now, this keeps coming back and again throughout the episode and has a very poor payoff at the end.
Yes, no, yeah, it does. It's an interesting... Have we had any other episodes with like some sort of interstitial framing device like this? I don't think we have.
No, I don't think we have yet, no.
Yeah, so it's, this Blofeld fella, it's the classic Blofeld that you don't see his face, you just see him stroking the cat and operating things. Although I did catch his...
As did I.
Yeah, you catch his reflection slightly in one of the monitors. Mm. And they have actually used the bald man, even though you never see him, you never see his head in the entire episode. They have actually, used the bald man.
For the tiny reflection I saw, he looked a bit like Rene from A Low, Low.
See, I thought...
He was a very unthreatening person.
See, I thought with his double chin, he looked like Fred Elliott from Coronation Street. But yeah, and also between each of these little framing bits, it has these really, really of-the-age computer graphics as well, doesn't it, around the frame.
Yeah.
Meaningless, just sort of adding some sort of spy element to it. Right, shall we go for a quick boat ride?
Yeah.
So it's full speed ahead to help Agent Snow with our mission to find the nerve centre of Britain's defences. The fictional HQ gets blown up in the new Bond film, The World Is Not Enough, which opens next week. In it, 007 chases the bomber down this stretch of Thames at high speed in a fantastic speedboat. Now, it's always the same. We always know what to expect from Bond. He always gets the meanest machines. But even he hasn't got his hands on a backpack helicopter. In an ideal world, there are certain things no Bond girl should be without. Top car, the freedom to drive in exotic locations. A handsome man by her side. Well, perhaps not. But now, at a top-secret facility hidden away in the Japanese highlands, they're developing that quintessential special something. That piece of indispensable high-tech kit that will really get you noticed. When all the fancy gadget-packed cars in the world are not enough. Well, all right, it's a small engineering company and it's not really hidden. More difficult to find. But they are building something here. Seems too good to be true. The world's first personal helicopter! It's the one piece of kit that James Bond would love to get his hands on, but we've beaten him to it. With four special lightweight engines, it can cruise at speeds of 100 kilometers per hour for 30 minutes on a full tank of petrol. And with an ability to reach an altitude of 3,000 meters, it should allow you to drop in on the hideaway mountain base of the most nefarious supervillain.
Mark, can I do a quick Roger Moore impression?
Do you have to? Yes, go for it.
That young lady clearly knows how to handle a chopper.
Very good, like Russell, it? Yeah. Yeah, I did, actually. That was better than I expected. Better than I feared, yeah.
Well, shall I tell you, before we get into this, shall I tell you about Philippa Forrester?
Yes, please
do. I've been doing a bit of research this afternoon.
I'm sure you have.
Listeners may not realise, but I always do all of my research for every episode on the day of transmission.
Oh, I think they've realised. Recording, yeah.
So I did fall in a bit of a tunnel here. So it's a good job that all of the subsequent inventions were pretty easy to research. So anyway, so to confirm the spelling, because I was thinking, right, if you've got double letters in your name, it's absolute murder, people misspelling your name. You won't suffer from this, Mark. But
no, I don't, yeah, but you do.
Just being called Russell, right, even though everyone in the world spells Russell, with double S, double L, about 90% of the time it gets spelt wrong. Poor old Philippa Forrester, she's got one, possibly two L's, one, possibly two P's, and one, possibly two R's. It's actually one L, two P's, two R's. So remember that, if you're ever writing her a letter or anything like that, an email. Anyway, she's born on the 20th of September, 1968. I mean, she's 53 years old now, which I think makes her the youngest presenter we've ever had. I presume it would do. Can't think of anybody younger than that.
Oh, is there not one later on who might be slightly younger?
Do you reckon Kate Humble's younger than her?
I can't. No, I mean in this episode.
Oh, yeah. We haven't got to her yet.
No, spoiler alert. So, she must be... Yeah, maybe Kate... Yeah. Anyway, yeah. One
Hang
off,
on,
not.
Let me check. Let's see how old Kate Humble is.
Yeah.
Oh, bloody hell. Kate Humble was born in 1968 as well, so...
Wow.
Kate Humble's
girl fight.
Yeah, December 1968. So Kate Humble's 3 years, 3 months younger than Philippa Forrester. Born in Winchester. She went to Westgate Comprehensive School. Got an English degree from Birmingham. Also, while she was working on Tomorrow's World, she got another degree. She went to Birkbeck College in London and got an ecology and conservation degree part time. Got a first.
Very good.
Got a first in that.
Very impressive.
But then, then her first job was she got a job reading out Christmas cards on British Forces Broadcasting in 1986. She would have been 18 years old then. I wonder what the squaddies thought of that. But anyway, I went on the broomcupboard.co.uk, which is an amazing website. Okay, it looks like it was designed 20 years ago, but it must be made by somebody who worked on the broom cupboard, because it is exhaustive, absolutely exhaustive in the amount of detail it has. It has all of the names, all of the dates, everything you could possibly imagine about the broom cupboard. And it even has like little sort of YouTube videos of different parts as you go along, so you can watch the little different bits it's talking about, right? So I spent about an hour and a half just on that website, to be honest, Mark. It's quite interesting. But yeah, she was still a student. So there was a thing called But First This, which ran during the summer holidays, which was like the morning CBBC thing. So she got a job on there as a student alongside the often forgotten one, Simon Parkin, who I'm sure... Do you remember Simon Parkin?
Rings a bell, yeah.
He sort of had ginger hair. But they introduced it together along with a third woman called Claudia Simon, who I don't remember at all. But they on that broom cupboard site, they've actually got a clip of her first ever like day presenting it, and it's amazing because the first time on the screen, she's absolutely, I mean, I'm sure she must be terrified because it's live, but she's absolutely awful. But then it cuts to the next scene, and she comes on screen and she's absolutely fine. So I think it must have been nerves really, rather than, you know, anything else. But yeah, so she was then the next, so she carried on doing this. She did it in the next year in the holidays, but Claudia had been binned off already, and she was replaced by Esther McVeigh, who, who now, obviously now is who she worked for, DWP. She's a horrible Tory minister now, isn't she, Esther McVeigh?
She's not one of the good ones.
She's not one of the good ones. And I thought, you know, imagine if Philippa Forrester had become an evil Tory minister. How the world would be different. But yeah, so then I was getting really into this at this point. And so the website is split into two, and it ended at 1992. And then so when I clicked onto the next page to see what happened between 1992 and 1996, it just said coming soon.
Coming, I can see it there, coming soon, yeah.
And then it said like last updated 2013. So please, if you're listening, whoever created this website, can you please write the second half of it? Because it's genuinely interesting and genuinely good. But yeah, so anyway, so she presented CBBC in 1994, she presented The Ozone, and then she joined Tomorrow's World in 1995, just as a reporter. And then, obviously, as I said before, she got upgraded to presenter in 1997. But at the same time, in 1998, she started presenting Robot Wars. Oh, that's probably what popularised her a lot with people. I never really liked Robot Wars. I thought it was a bit crap, to be honest. And I actually think the most fun to be derived from it was her interviewing awkward schoolgirls.
Oh God,
that was always fun to watch.
Yeah.
And during this time, she was the ultimate accolade was that she was voted the 42nd sexiest woman in the world by the readers of FHM magazine. I don't know what the 41 ones in front of her were, but according to her online CV, she's very proud of this. I don't recall Judith Han ever appearing in those rankings. I've not checked, but it certainly wasn't mentioned on Judith Han's CV. But yeah.
No.
Yeah, so one thing she did do that I'd forgotten that she did, that you'll remember, Mark, is she did the coverage of the eclipse.
I do remember that, yes.
Where we watched it from your back garden, didn't we?
From our front garden, using my brother's Final Fantasy VII PlayStation discs to protect us from the blast of the sun, if memory serves me correct, before immediately getting back inside and carrying on drinking.
Because I think we were all advised at the time that PlayStation discs were absolutely fine for viewing the sun through, weren't we?
Oh, yeah, that. I didn't believe it, so I thought, well, I'm going to try it out. And I think I remember looking up through the disc at the sun going, like, this works perfectly.
Although, noticeably, you do wear glasses these days. You never used to wear glasses back then.
Not just that, but I have to wear two different pairs for different things now as well, yeah.
So, yeah, so after leaving, she left Tomorrow's World in 2001, and then presented loads of stuff that neither of us would ever possibly watch. Like the Heaven and Earth show, which is some sort of spiritual discussion program. And then like lots of dog stuff like Crufts and a program called Barking Mad. And then like lots of those, you know, those sort of documentaries that are like opposite of Attenborough, where it's clearly made for people who are only interested in like fluffy little animals. So it'd be like a program about baby otters or things like that. You know what I mean? Presented loads of those programs.
Nature not read in fur and paw.
Absolutely no chance of like any sort of savagery whatsoever.
No reality.
Yeah, exactly. But she presents, I mean, I'm not going to go through them. There's all sorts of ones of those. But she married a cameraman from the National Geographic and then moved to Wyoming, just outside Yellowstone Park.
Ah, see, that's where he's working.
With, where he's working. They had three sons. And while she was out there, she got really involved in Wolves and like started following
the Wolverhampton Wanderers football club.
Yeah. Started wearing orange scarves.
Big Steve Bull fan, I reckon, from that time. Yeah.
No, she wrote a book called On the Trail of Wolves. Well, I don't know how popular it was, but it only came out last year.
Relatively recent.
Imagine probably she was on wanted to go on some sort of big campaign, you know, publicity campaign trail, which was probably cut short by COVID, I would have thought.
Oh, yeah, that's true. Yeah. Yeah.
But it's available at all good Amazon sites. But she's now, according to her agent's page, which is actually up to date, surprisingly. It says that she has now recently returned to the UK after living in the USA and is ready to come back onto our screens.
Oh,
so we might be seeing her. You know, we might be seeing her back on our screens at some point soon.
Neither of us would complain about that.
I looked on her Twitter, and she's doing a lot of loads of videos about electric cars. So she must have been paid by somebody in the electric car. I can't imagine she's doing her own. Well, maybe she is. Maybe she just loves electric cars. But yeah, she's doing a lot of educational videos about electric cars. And I think she's barely changed. She looks almost exactly the same in those videos. It's remarkable. It's like she's got some sort of secret of eternal youth.
Well, I look forward to hopefully seeing her on our screen sometime soon.
Yeah.
Because she was good.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
She's good in this. And she was actually good in the previous episode we saw her in, which is not a great episode. And she was asked to talk about something that we did, you know, you did your research, and the fake sense was obviously utter nonsense. But she did have that effect, didn't she? The robot wars effect, where obviously everyone she was talking to was completely smitten by her and clearly very unused to being having the attention of an attractive English woman.
Yeah.
It's quite a skill.
And I think she does play up to that. I get the impression that she knows what she's doing, and it's a good way of getting stuff out of her interviewees.
Yeah, why not? But again, I think you're right. I mean, we can talk about it too much, but at no point in this episode does she not seem genuinely interested in what she's listening to and who she's listening to. Now, obviously, that's a skill, but at the same time, you know, she seems quite genuine. There's nothing about Philippa Forrester's career that makes you think she's some kind of cynical genius.
No, not at all.
No, I think she just seems quite fun and quite open to the idea of learning from interesting people who I think probably do enjoy the attention she gives them.
Yeah, absolutely.
Speaking of which, should we talk about John Plummer and his Japanese cohorts?
John Plummer's chopper.
Yeah, let's do it.
Well, first of all,
she's in Japan.
She's in Japan.
So she's on location in Japan on one of the wettest days I've seen on Tomorrow's World so far.
It's absolutely tipping it down.
It's tipping it down.
I mean,
so obviously they have her driving around in a convertible with the roof down.
She's getting absolutely soaked in that car. Absolutely soaked.
It almost is cruel.
One nice touch, though, is they do open with You Only Live Twice music, which, James Bond film set in Japan. Thought that was a nice touch. But then, they make no attempt to... It's almost as if they had no rain protection available, because the only rain protection you see anywhere in this thing is a sort of what looks like an umbrella from, an ice cream hut or something, which they place on top of the helicopter when it's not in use.
Yeah.
Everyone else is just prepared to get utterly soaked throughout.
And clearly, as the filming goes on, it's getting wetter and wetter. And the rain is coming down more and more.
Yeah.
I have no doubt that if you're not watching this on YouTube, you're listening on podcasts, which is really what you're supposed to be doing. You'll hear the rain. It's very audible because it is obviously landing on every single surface within the radius of the microphone.
But does this mean that they had a really short window of time?
It has to mean that. Partly because she says that the helicopter... So let's describe the helicopter, because she talks about a backpack helicopter, which I think is... It's not unfair, but it's also not really accurate. Because what it is, it's like a... it's a seat, like an office... Well, not even like an office seat. It's like a roller coaster style seat, kind of molded. Mm. So imagine a kind of a backpack to the back of that seat. And then you have two sets of rotor blades with a radius of, I don't know, what would you say, Russ? Meter and a half?
Yeah, something like that.
And So it's relatively large. And actually the seat itself is lifted off the ground by a good 2-3 feet on these kind of legs. So this is a relatively large object. Now, in comparison to a helicopter, it's obviously tiny, but it's not quite a backpack helicopter, or she calls it a strap-on helicopter at one point. That's probably going a bit too far. So one thing when she's going on and talking about it, she says that it can be learned in 3 hours. Now, the fact that she never flies it means they didn't have...
Because
the obvious thing would be to have her fly
exactly.
it, to kind of go through the process of learning. She's smart. I'm sure she would have been happy to do it, but she doesn't. So I reckon they probably only had 2 or 3 hours to film the whole thing. And the fact that it's pissing it down means that you just got to get on with it.
Yeah. I mean, glad it still works in the rain, really. Otherwise, they'd be buggered, wouldn't they?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, I don't know what they're doing.
Or maybe there was a thunderstorm coming and they wanted to get it filmed before the
before it gets really dangerous, yeah.
Yeah.
Because it's actually quite a flat area they're in, so it really would be the tallest point by quite some margin.
Yeah. I mean, when I first saw it, I mean, if you say to somebody, oh, it's a helicopter you strap to your back, it does sound pretty dangerous, doesn't it? I mean, you have images in your mind of, well, decapitation, basically. Any helicopter conjures up the images of decapitation. But then I thought, well, because the rotor is, the center of the rotor is so close to you, I don't think you would even be able to decapitate yourself with it. It would.
No.
The blade would just fly away from you. So you'd probably be the safest person if anything happened to the blades. You're not going to be in the firing range or anything like that.
It's interesting because it looks very homemade.
Yes.
Sophisticated homemade. I mean, it looks. They talk about the fact that, like, they'll be sold as kits. So, like, a jobbing person with the right tools would be able to construct it. It does look homemade. But as I said to you in the notes, like, it looks, it all makes sense and it looks quite safe, I think. The idea is that the rotor blades are above you. They are on a kind of a moving kind of gimbal, like a ball and socket joint thing. So in front of you, coming down from the set of above you, is a kind of a vertical pole with two little handles. But if you push forward, you go backwards. If you pull back, you go forward. And you can then, using your own body weight, you can shift it so that you're left and right. It all actually looks like it makes sense. It really does look like, you know, someone could learn to use it in 3 hours. It's a pretty decent setup. And the fact that it looks homemade, I think, kind of makes it kind of endearing and makes it understandable.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I can see why they went there, because it's unlike, I'm sure, other products that were being made at the time. This looks like it could go somewhere. And as you rightly point out, I as a child when I was growing up, the idea of strapping a jetpack onto you, like the Rocketeer, seems so inherently dangerous. Yeah. And it just feels like if you have a cramp in your leg and you have to pull up, like, you're burning your foot off.
Yes, good point, yeah.
Yeah, whereas, like, you know, with this, you sat down, up you go, down you, and even if it stopped, like, you kind of feel like you would just gently come down, not gently come down, but, like, you know, you're never going to be so high up that you're going to be terribly injured.
No, no.
Yeah.
Would you be interested to know, Mark, that this was a halfway success in that it's called the Gen H4, and it was kind of brought into production, but not really. So they built enough prototypes for it to pass all of the necessary aviation regulations. So if they would have been able to sell them all across Japan, and even in the United States, they passed those regulations as well. So they could have sold them in America.
By the way, nice bit of shade there thrown at the US. That they're having to make a special version for the fat, chubby chubsters in the States.
But the problem came is that they couldn't find enough dealers for them. I think people weren't prepared to go out on a limb to go, yeah, we'll start selling these. And they worked out that they would have to make them in order to be cost effective, they'd have to make them in batches of 10. And they just couldn't get 10 orders at a time. They couldn't. So they would have cost, if it had gone ahead, they would cost you $81,000 for one, which I think not bad for a personal helicopter. Is that bad for a personal helicopter? I'm not sure.
I don't think so.
I think helicopters are quite expensive, aren't they?
I think helicopters are very expensive.
Yeah, yeah. So they pulled the plug in 2012, having only made prototypes because they didn't get enough orders.
That's interesting, because when you described it, that they were looking for people to kind of retail through, I was thinking, like, oh, that's a shame. You know, 99, it's probably really before e-commerce blew up. I mean, we had the dot-com bubble, what was that, 2001, and that's when all, like, boo.com and, like, all these companies that, like, just appeared in 2 years kind of exploded. But if they'd been going all the way through to 2012, they could have sold over the internet. So there just wasn't the market there for them at all, really.
No. Well, we saw the I can't remember his name. It was Jen something. Where's his name gone? The guy who owns the company, who was an old engineer, and we see him in the VT. Don't
we do.
We?
It's brilliant.
Inspecting his factory
in full two-piece double-breasted suit. You know,
with all
his
other Japanese co-workers who we hear nothing from. Any
Zip.
Of them?
Zilch.
Nada. You know, not even like a. I can understand they might not speak English, but it could be like a subtitled bit or a.
Yeah,
or
of course, good. Yeah.
No, no. The only person we speak to is the one. I don't know where he's from. He sounds vaguely European guy. I'm not sure.
I thought he was American. It sounded American to me.
I thought he was
John Plummer. No, I thought he was American.
Oh, right. But he, I don't think he gave up, because apparently currently the Gen company corporation is trying to make a development of this where it's a personal helicopter, but you don't have to pilot it yourself. So it's almost like a cross between a drone and a personal helicopter. Mm. So it'll be able to carry people, but they're not piloting it. That's what they're currently working on. And I looked at whether there's any accidents with these while they were testing these little personal choppers. And there was only ever one accident in 2000 when a pilot was hovering, got hit by a gust of wind and bashed into a building, but he was only slightly injured. So safe as houses, Mark. So still the safest way to travel, flying.
True.
Even in a personal helicopter.
Yeah. One injury, no deaths. Yeah. Very good.
Before I crack on with our mission to reveal that secret room, I've got a rendezvous with a man who claims he has the ultimate spy kit for the real 007.
No real spy is complete without bugging devices and hidden cameras. In the shadowy world of surveillance, every spy must have undetectable eyes and ears. 007 is often kitted out by Q with bizarre kinds of hidden microphones and cameras, but reality is just as intriguing. Michael Marks, the man I'm meeting, supplies some very high-tech gear.
Hello, Peter.
Michael, how did you know I was here?
I've been filming you.
Rubbish inventions, Mark, but I think there's some interesting things to be said about this segment.
Mm.
First of all, something you noticed, which cannot be unnoticed.
Mm.
Peter Snow's...
That which is seen cannot be unseen.
Peter Snow's laces.
Yes.
You'd like to describe what's happening there?
the fact that you... The way you said that. People are now going to imagine, well, yeah, absolutely, the entire time they bizarrely were knotted into the shape of a swastika, Russ. No, they were undone. They were untied.
Yeah.
And the thing that really got me... First things first. Well, whoever helped him get into that car, well done for folding up enough times to get him into that Aston Martin. His head is almost kind of at a right angle against the roof. Yeah, so we watch him come into this corridor in this corporate headquarters, and we actually see like a close-up of his feet walking along, and his laces are undone. And
not just a bit, like fully.
No, like literally out, so, flying around. Yeah, like a 4-year-old. And who doesn't see that?
Especially when they're filming only his feet.
Yes, it's literally just a shot, a locked off shot of his feet. The thing is, I appreciate Peter Snow is tall, so he's a long way from his shoelaces. He may not be able to see that they're tied or not tied. But whoever set that shot up and watched it, I don't know, there's something later on that also slightly annoyed me in a very similar way.
So I thought, this cannot, this must be deliberate. I thought...
It has to be, doesn't it?
So I thought, what can I... So I looked for shoelace references in James Bond, so if in case there was some bit that I'd forgotten happened where he has to untie shoelaces to meet somebody or anything like that. No, but I did type in spies shoelaces. And I'm going to, and this is definitely not what Peter Snow is doing, but it did throw up something quite interesting, which I'll just throw in here. So there's a thing called the Official CIA Manual of Trickery and Deception, which sounds like it's not real, but is genuine.
It really
was the Official CIA Manual of Trickery and Deception during the 1950s. And it obviously got declassified, and you can now buy it on Amazon. And there is one segment in it which advises spies that because shoes are only tied in one way and nobody really looks at them, if you've got two spies looking for each other, if they tie them in a different way, no one else is going to notice unless the spies are looking for it. So they recommend it as a way of two spies passing messages or reaching contact with each other. And it's got recommended ways of tying your shoelaces. But nowhere, even in that CIA manual, does it suggest that you walk around with your laces undone, like some sort of...
No, because that's just really dangerous. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, it's great that you found that, Russ.
Yeah.
Did you just out of interest, did you type in Peter Snow and untie shoelaces and just find out that he just can't tie his shoelaces?
Maybe it's like the Snow family are notorious for their shit lucky charm things, aren't they? Hang on.
Oh, you think?
Well, what's his name? That John Snow does that thing with his socks, doesn't he? I didn't even think about that. Hang on.
And his ties. And what's Peter's son? What's his name?
No results for that.
Oh, that's a shame. Dan Snow, isn't it? Oh, what if Dan Snow, as a result of his dad's inability to tie a shoelace, do you think he only has Velcro shoes?
So he just leaves his flies undone all the time.
Oh, there we go. For good luck. Yeah.
Yeah, so...
Anyway, that infuriated me. Next.
So this segment, let's just say that this segment is just a bloke turning up and showing Peter Snow a series of our almost near novelty items.
Absolutely. That's a really... Yeah.
But... I did find out who this man was, but before we get to that, I want to talk about the filming of it as well.
Mm.
Because they're using a lot of tricks here to try and make it look like Peter Snow's being under surveillance. And right, so he's filmed with lots of different really poor quality cameras. But there's one thing that they do with the camera, and I don't understand what they're doing. Why is there one camera that turns everything slightly trapezoidal so that everything's a slope and like they all look out of proportion and the windows are all wonky? Because what spy camera does that? Like
Well, I'm not a spy, Russ, so I don't know, but a bad one?
It seemed really weird to me, and there was no explanation for it. I thought at one point that they were actually going to reach for the camera and they were filming them and show it was some sort of special, I don't know, pint glass of spy, you know, or something like that, and that's why, you know what I mean?
That would have been a good payoff. Yeah, that would have been good. But that doesn't happen. It's just... I was really annoyed that we didn't fast forward through that segment watching it there. So it's the guy's name, Michael Marks, isn't it? So wooden. He's really wooden, which I sometimes find really endearing. You know, I can find endearing when normal people are on TV, and obviously, like, they're trying their darndest, but like, it's not a natural thing. And it's a reminder of what a skill being a TV presenter is when you see normal people go on trying to play alone. Yeah. He's really wooden in a really creepy way. And then he basically, as you say, it's not spy equipment, because obviously, you know, MI6 don't use this when they're going through the Balkans. It's probably not even stuff that's kind of used in like industrial espionage. It's really novelty.
What's he got? He's got a briefcase with a camera in it.
Yeah. Very old fashioned cigarette box.
A box of cigarettes the size of a VCR, and proportions of a VCR. With no branding on, so even if you were spying on somebody, you'd only be able to use it within inside the confines of the BBC.
And you couldn't offer anyone cigarettes because there are no cigarettes in it. Not even like, you know, like normally you have like one or two where you go, like, oh, here, have a cigarette. Look, it's clearly real because I've given you a cigarette.
Not a cigarette, and then they reach for it, just pull a camera out, light it.
Yeah, she says, like, can I offer you a cigarette? He says, no, thank you, I don't smoke. And he goes, well, that's good, because there's no cigarettes in here. It's like, well, don't offer them then, Michael. You've been rumbled.
Yeah, a pair of walkie-talkies that can send pictures to each other.
Yeah.
And a bug tracking device. Is that all of them? I think that's all of them.
Well, it's the bug he puts in his pocket, which we never see, and then a bug tracking device, which he points at the pocket, knowing a bug's there. I wonder how... It's the size of a pen with an a bit of metal that comes out like a car aerial, and he points it at Peter Snow's jacket pocket, and it has a light on the back of it, a bit like the moisture meter from two episodes ago. And he goes, "Oh, look, that bug I put there—it's still there." And Peter's like, "No, Michael."
Yeah. So actually, think about it. There's no other indicator on it. So you would have to know the bug was there in order to point the bug detector at it.
Yeah. Otherwise, with the surface area of the end of the TV aerial coming out of that pen, you would be in a room for days,
for quite a long time,
touching every single surface.
Yeah. So yeah. Well, I mean. Yeah, so
that's it. Yes, that's the list.
Everything's rubbish. And
rubbish.
It didn't surprise me to discover that Mr. Michael Marks is one of these founders and people that ran a shop in London, which was quite famous in the 90s, called Spymaster.
That's the one.
Yeah. Which came first, Thighmaster or Spymaster?
Oh, what a great question. It has to be, like, there must be spy masters, like, in Carrey novels.
So I guess Thighmaster must have been based on that, and then this was based on that. Anyway. So his brother Lee and him, and their nephew Jeremy set it up. And I found an interview with Lee, the brother. I thought it was quite interesting. So they're old stockbrokers whose business went bust. So I think that's why Michael gives off the air of a slight spivvy nature to him. But yeah, so Lee says in this interview with Independent, this is way back way back when this was still a sort of going concern. But it said, however, we had come across some people, especially Arabs, who were very interested in surveillance products, which were very difficult to find. Basically, they wanted things like bugging devices and covert cameras. So we decided to switch the emphasis of our business onto surveillance. And we started up in the basement of my house in St. John's Wood. What we did was take out display cases at places like the Churchill Hotel and Hilton in Park Lane and advertise our wares. And we quickly found that we had a lot of people coming to see us at my home. It started to become very successful. We would be visited by very wealthy tourists, and we suddenly realised that there was a big market for this kind of thing. It was not necessarily an English market, more an export market. I know these products are kind of harmless, but it just immediately sounded like the sort of things that arms dealers say, you know, inviting, you know, wealthy Arabs to their hotels to show off their wares.
Or the way the City of London has allowed itself be used to launder Russian oligarchical money for two decades at the expense of human rights.
And then,
so it's all fun and games for us.
And then lo and behold, they immediately started, they expanded and started selling bulletproof vests, nuclear and biological warfare suits, gas masks. And then I asked about, you know, the moral implications of this. He said, it is utterly impossible to get involved in any moral or ethical issues. Is it utterly impossible?
Oh, I hadn't really thought about it, but that's reassuring.
If someone wanted to buy a bug, it would be offensive to ask what they wanted it for. Well, yeah, I guess so, yeah.
I can see how it's unprofessional, but I don't think it's offensive.
No.
Ooh, who are you going to bug? Can I listen in?
Well, the thing is, there's a spy shop really, really close to my house here in Amsterdam. And it's called The Spy Shop, I think. And I walk past it on the way to Aldi. And I, you know, keep my eyes peeled for spies coming in, you know, going out the shop.
Of course.
And I don't know whether the Dutch secret services are exclusively employing pervy-looking old men or what. But those are the only people I've ever seen coming in and out of that shop. I don't know what...
Curious, isn't it?
I don't know what the espionage activities they're up to, but I'm sure it's no good. So anyway, the company went bust in 2017 because, ironically, they had a terrible website and didn't capitalise on selling stuff over the internet.
So foolish, okay.
So you'd think, we're these techno experts. But no, they got beaten out by all of the online spies where people. But the one I think that radio thing when we watched it,
they're like walkie talkies with screens and they're kind of a rotating camera on the top.
So it's a weird thing, isn't it? So because it's not they're not mobile phones. They are actual walkie talkies, but they have essentially a camera phone on them, which is transmitted via walkie talkie, which is technologically quite interesting.
Oh, they're made by Kenwood.
Yeah. They're technologically quite interesting, but you think, what is the possible, we were speculating what the possible use of that would be. So I looked into it, and these things are useless, yes, but the technology they use, actually, super useful. So the technology that they use, because as they mentioned, it uses a tiny amount of bandwidth, so you can, it uses very low power. But the pictures are rubbish. But what that's good for is space missions. So all of the very early space missions, it's called SSTV, slow scan television. So all of those famous early photos of space missions that we've seen, like those dogs in space and like Yuri Gagarin and the early Apollo missions, they all use this technology to beam the pictures back to Earth, because they obviously didn't have the power to beam back proper TV pictures or anything like that.
No, I was wondering how they did it.
This was the technology they used. But this Kenwood, obviously then it got superseded by something better. And this Kenwood thing is literally just for radio enthusiasts. It wasn't made for any, you know, practical application whatsoever. It's just that there's loads of people out there who just are interested in old radio things and what it can do. And it's just for them to like chat to each other and stuff. So if you type in this Kenwood thing in the internet, it's just people with pure interest in radio chatting about it.
Oh,
and you know,
that's quite
sweet. You can buy a secondhand one for quite cheap if you want one, Mark. But I mean, you'd have to find out a fellow. Well, maybe we. I don't think we actually don't have the range between Amsterdam and London. I don't think.
I was going to say, what's the range? I don't suppose it's 4 miles, or whatever.
Yeah. But that was one little interesting thing to come out of this segment that I quite enjoyed there. You know.
That's quite sweet, isn't it? Oh, all right. Oh.
Fancy a drink?
Now, we all know the routine. A dry martini, shaken, not stirred. And I know I'm meant to be helping Peter find Britain's most closely guarded room, but I can't help thinking I've got just a little bit of time to investigate Bond's favourite cocktail.
Legend has it, in Ian Fleming's original books, Bond's martini was stirred, not shaken. Because after a hard day thwarting evil, Bond might be stirred, yes, but shaken, never. The film studio thought it sounded better the other way around. So Bond's cocktail is shaken, not stirred. But which is better?
Now, here's a man who knows a bit about the perfect martini. Dr. David Clutton has spent his working life studying gin. So if anyone should know about martinis, then it should be you.
Well, I guess that's right, yes. The origins of the martini are somewhat debatable. Vodka martinis became pretty fashionable, but the true connoisseur of a martini always uses one spirit, and that's London Dry Gin. The other ingredients are vermouth and ice, lots of cold. So regardless of what recipe you use, there are three scientific secrets which you need to make the perfect martini. If your liquids are too warm, the ice cubes will melt far too quickly and your drink will become very watery. So it's fundamental to keep your gin in the freezer, your vermouth in the fridge, and your cocktail shaker as cold as possible. Well, dry in this context actually doesn't mean not wet. It means low in sugar, low in sweetness.
So can we measure dryness?
You can measure dryness essentially using techniques like gas chromatography and electronic nose technology and things like that. But at the end of the day, you know, there's only one way to check the dryness. And that's in the usual sort of way.
Yes.
So cheers.
Cheers to you. Does it make any difference at all?
Well, I think it probably does, you know, because if you think about it, if you stir something like that, all you do is create a vortex in the middle of the liquid. But if you put your ice with your liquids in a shaker and shake it vigorously, you get much more effective heat transfer.
Right.
So the liquid becomes much cooler.
Well, Dr. Clutton may say that scientifically shaken, not stirred, is best, but not everyone agrees. Take Cynthia, for example, the world's first barmaid robot. She's programmed with 75 different cocktails, including a martini. But it's stirred, not shaken. So which tastes better? Well, there's only one way to find out. We'll have to taste them.
Have you ever heard Noel Coward's perfect martini recipe, Mark?
Possibly, but I don't recall it. Russ, do tell.
A perfect martini should be made by filling a glass with gin and then just waving it in the general direction of Italy.
Yes, indeed, I have heard that.
I know you're with me here.
What a wit.
Yeah, I know you're with me here, Mark. The incessant discussion around the concept of either shaking or stirring martinis bores the absolute tits off me.
Oh, I'm so glad you said that. When I read that down, I felt like I was screaming into the wind. Because I think of all the tropes from James Bond that have been popularized and that people have a real fondness towards, the one that I think is least deserving is him ordering a martini in every film and saying, shaken, not stirred. It bores the tits off me, mostly because, as you said, like a martini is a perfectly fine drink, but it's not the greatest drink of all time.
No.
And, you know, there's much better things, to be frank. A gin and tonic for a start.
Yeah. I was thinking about this, this afternoon. Why has it become, and it had it like it's become ludicrously over discussed thing.
Mm.
And I was wondering, is it just because of the way Sean Connery pronounces it, because of his particular way of pronouncing S's?
Oh, yeah,
that it captured everybody's imagination then, and that somehow as a sort of catched in everybody's minds, and then they never stopped talking about it.
It's the quickest way of doing an impression of Sean Connery.
Exactly.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
Except saying his name.
Yeah.
That's a really good point.
But, so anybody listening, I am not going to go into the science of shaking or stirring martinis because every bloody media outlet, every single time a James Bond film
discusses it.
Yeah. I know, like in the most recent Commode and Mayo film review programs, they've been incessantly talking about it. They talk about it. Everybody talks about it. It drives me mad. No one cares or knows why James Bond had it shaken, not stirred. It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
It just probably sounded good to England. Who cares? Also, Philippa Forrester, and you know I wouldn't hear a word against her name. However,
no, you won't.
She engages in some Rod-esque fabrication at the beginning of this. This segment.
Yeah.
She uses the immortal words "legend has it," and then goes into some nonsense about Ian Fleming's original book, saying that he wanted it stirred, not shaken, and all this utter garbage. I mean, in all of the books, he asked for it shaken, not stirred. He never asked for it stirred, not shaken. Easily checkable by checking the novels, which were readily available at the time. They've been out since the 50s. So I don't know where she got this fact from or how they included it. It's just almost like they wanted to throw a lie in.
Mm.
Bizarre. In fact, the only time he does, apparently, the only time he does ask for it stirred, not shaken, is in the film You Only Live Twice. Somebody says, hands it to him and says, stirred, not shaken. And he says, perfect. Which shows what little quality control they must have had when they made films back then. They didn't even notice that they got the words the wrong way around.
The line
wrong way around.
Delivered correctly, yeah, yeah.
And the only other good thing which I found out, which I think goes into my thing that Roger Moore is the best James Bond, is that at no point in any of his films does he ever ask for a martini shaken, not stirred. Somebody else always asks for it for him.
Really?
And just hands it to him. Yeah. Which I think sums up Roger Moore perfectly. Minimum effort, maximum outcome.
Minimum effort, maximum outcome. Yeah, okay. Because, you know, you and I have always disagreed on the whole Roger Moore thing. Because I just think, I know, this is not a James Bond discussion. Oh, that's really interesting. I don't think I'd ever spot it. I assume they'd always ordered it, which is why I quite like the delivery in Casino Royale where somebody asks, you know, he's had a bad day, he asks for a martini, and then the guy says, shaken or stirred? He goes, do I look like I give a damn? Which I just thought was, I remember laughing at the time because it was like, yeah, you're damn right. Who gives a flying F?
Yeah.
You know, just get it in me.
But I always thought that the use of damn is too American for me, Mark.
It is. You're not wrong.
You should have said,
it's the sentiment I enjoy.
You should have either said two shits or monkeys. A proper British person.
As we all say.
But anyway, yeah, so to picture the scene, to set the scene, Philippa walking into a very bizarre looking sort of subterranean cocktail bar. The walls are covered in that sort of, I don't know what it's called, but it's that sort of metal that covers like fire escape floors or the floors of...
Yes, kind of galvanized steel. Yeah.
With little
bumps. I've not looked it up, but if I had to guess, I'd say this is a tunnel under London Bridge. Because it does, the chyron comes up saying Southwark, London.
Yes, yeah.
So I assume it has to be one of the old tunnels under London Bridge or the rail leaving it. And it's actually quite a nice shot. Like she comes in the door, she's bathing, like you'll hear it on the audio. You'll hear her striding along the corridor.
A lovely little strut down there.
Yep. Very elegant. Very, very, very impressive.
Lots of neon around
and
her.
It looks like a horrible, dreadful bar.
It does. It looks like if they'd taken everything that I think would be the nicest thing about a pub and picked the absolute reverse of everything that is and turned that into a pub.
So if you happen to be a sexy lady in Amsterdam listening to this and you find Russell on Tinder, you know where not to take
him. Well, I'll tell you what, a lot of the places in Amsterdam are the reverse of this. All of the walls are covered in dark brown wood. There's barely any lighting.
It's fabulous.
It is literally the opposite of this. No robots behind the bar.
we'll talk about Cynthia in a minute.
Yeah, so then she walks in. We just see a normal cocktail barman doing that nonsense they do. And a more mature gent wearing a roll neck sweater reclining at the bar.
This is Dr. David Clutton.
Yes.
His job title is Drinks Chemist.
Drinks Chemist.
Yeah, he's resplendent in a kind of a black polo neck jumper and a black suit jacket with a red handkerchief. It's not a pocket square, it's kind of pouring out. He looks the part. He looks, to be honest, he doesn't look the part because no one could look the part in that particular cocktail bar. But he looks the part for like any other cocktail bar in London, of which there are many good ones.
Yes, yeah. And I thought maybe he was a slightly, you know, trying to go for a little bit of a James Bondy type look. I mean, the roll neck is, you know, a lot of people wear roll necks in James Bond, not just James Bond. A few of the others, his enemies and things like that, wear them as well.
Indeed, very popular.
Yeah, and then
but he's good though. He's really interesting, really knowledgeable.
Yeah, and then obviously they chat this bollocks about shaken or stirred that we don't care about, and then we are introduced to Cynthia. one of the worst looking robots I have ever seen in my entire life. She's atrocious. Like, she
absolutely appalling.
Like proper 1970s Doctor Who again, isn't it? It's like probably worse than 1970s Doctor Who.
It's worse than that because we've moved 20 years into the future, if not nearly 30.
Yeah,
it's like there is literally no excuse.
Yeah.
For how shunky she looks. And I was thinking about it today. Sorry, carry on describing her because I'll tell you what I was thinking about today.
Right now, she's got a weird sort of pair of big red eyes, just like wobbles as she goes around. And it's clearly, I think what's happening is that there is actually probably an actually fairly functional robot underneath, but it's one of those, you know, sort of like a factory type robot that doesn't really look like a humanoid. And they've tried.
And this is literally what I was thinking earlier. If you stripped all the nonsense away, you probably have two articulated arms and some kind of circuitry in the middle. Yeah. That would have looked 15 times better.
Yeah.
Because it would have looked like proper future nonsense, whereas this just looks like, like a really bad Doctor Who bad.
Yeah. And again, and then it mixes, it does its job. Genuinely does its job.
I don't think it's fake.
One of these martinis. Obviously, Philippa can't tell the difference because no one can, because the idea of being able to tell the difference between a small glass of nearly pure alcohol just because it's been moved differently is utterly insane.
And anyone who tells you otherwise is lying.
Yes, exactly. And as soon as I saw that robot, I thought, oh, I know, I can see what's happening here. This is some more BBC bunts. And I wrote it. You saw it, Mark, didn't I? I did. I wrote it in the thing. I
think I watched you type it live.
Really? Were you watching me type live? That must be annoying, watching me correct things.
Actually, it's more when you put in a joke and then immediately take it out.
I thought, I know what's happening here. What's happened is that one of the big major drinks companies, marketing department, they've seen that a Bond film's coming out. So they've gone, right, let's build this robot that makes the perfect martini so that we can tie it in with the Bond film. And we'll make it look like, obviously, we're marketing people. We're not actual roboticists. Is that what they're called? Roboticists, yeah, I guess it is. So we'll make it look like a cartoon science fiction robot, right? And then we can get our resident drinks.
Like Rosie from the Jetsons, rather,
and We can get our resident drinks bloke from our factory to come in and chat about it. Obviously, being the BBC, we won't name any names, but job still done. Get people out there drinking.
London Dry Gin.
Exactly.
That's what I picked up.
And I was prepared to sit here looking really smug, being pretty correct. But it turns out, Mark, the truth is so much more weird and depressing than that.
Okay,
let's, first of all, Dr. David Hutton, he's not a plant. Clutton. He's not a plant. Yeah. He's legit.
He's a real guy.
He's legit.
By the way, Dr. David Hutton was the weapons inspector who killed himself. So not the same person.
Oh, yeah, he was. Yeah. Yeah.
Actually, he's... Yeah, go on.
Well, you're about to incriminate somebody then.
No. No, I was just looking at the still we have we'll talk about it later, where the DB5 is parked up along Whitehall. And I was thinking, actually, the location of where Dr. David Hutton gave his interview to the journalist from Newsnight is about a 10-minute walk away from that location. The fateful interview.
Found him on LinkedIn.
Clutton, Dr. David Clutton. Not to be confused with Dr. David Hutton. And I'm holding up a book here, Russ.
Why did I write as Hutton then?
I don't know, because you've written Clutton in the notes. Anyway.
I've written Hutton and Clutton in my notes. That's why I was confused.
Okay.
Right, that makes sense. Right, okay. But he's on LinkedIn, and he's written his LinkedIn profile while he was pissed, because he's... I've never seen this before. He's not just written his name. He's written in capital letters, Gin, 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 Dr. David Clutton, Dr. Gin. Yeah, but he started working at Diageo in 1968. And when this program was on, he was working at Bacardi on the gin and rum department. Mm. And then these days, he's still working. He's an independent consultant these days for the gin industry. Clearly loves his gin.
I think you find that they call it the gin industry.
Oh, yeah, the gin industry. Of course they do.
And no evidence for that.
He has the world's only PhD on gin flavouring. I quite like that claim because you can choose your own PhD. I mean, so it just means nobody else has bothered to do one on gin flavouring. But he claims that. But yeah, so he's absolutely all above board and everything like that. And so then I looked up Cynthia cocktail robot, and I expected, obviously what I expected was like some sort of marketing puff piece saying, we've got this Cynthia. No, it turns out that there was an actual bar, this bar, opened merely 2 weeks before this on Tooley Street and London Bridge called Cynthia's Cyber Bar. And
this, oh my God.
And this was open to the public. This is like a proper going concern. It's actually, it's not an advert for a drinks company. It's also sort of an advert for Cynthia's Cyber Bar. But people would actually turn up and like come in and order their drinks, and Cynthia would make them for them, and then they could sit down and they'd have food as well. There was another bar with a different robot in it called Rasta, but I couldn't find any pictures of that one. And then there was another bar with humans in it. But obviously, because it's of the period, there's limited photography. There's no photographs of there being people in the bar.
What about all the people with their Kenwood TV walkie-talkies? Yeah. Why were they not?
But the Cynthia Cyber Bar website is still going. So and it's www.cynbar.co.uk. If you go on it, it's a very, very low fi website, like of the period website, and it's just got a picture of Cynthia, and it says Cynthia has retired.
Oh.
And then there's a photo section with all these photos, but there's no photo of any people ever in the bar. It's just Cynthia standing there looking really lonely behind the bar. I started to feel really sorry for her. But then there's actually a few reviews of it. The just like when it opened, there's Giles Corran in The Independent. He actually goes in there for a meal.
Okay.
He goes, this is like an abridged few bits from it. And he says, you are greeted by the bartender, who looks like one of the Cybermen in Doctor Who. Hello, she says, with the deep rasping warble you might get if Kit from Knight Rider was speaking through a voice scrambler. See, that's disappointing. We never heard her speak in this segment.
No, I didn't realise she spoke. Yeah. I assume she didn't.
This is odd because she is called Cynthia. In front of her is a keypad listing dozens of cocktails, all sweet, all vile, all intended to get teetotal secretaries drunk at an office Christmas party. Well, he goes on. He's actually quite impressed by the robot, how the robot works, and the drinks are delivered fine. But then he orders a meal, and he really, really absolutely slates the food, like proper, you know, proper coating down of the food totally. And then he just ends the article with, working here, Cynthia may soon do a RoboCop, go AWOL, vault over her counter and start killing diners, for whom death would be a blessed relief. So, the Cynthia Cyber Bar, Mark. Who thought that was a good idea? How long do you reckon it lasted? I couldn't find any sort of
2 years.
News articles saying when it closed down. It can't have lasted long.
I say 2 years, no more than that.
Do you think that...
Because I reckon 2 years is probably when they had a discount on the business rates or the rent from the landlord to see if it's a going concern before it goes up to market rates. No, they didn't last. I don't think they would have lasted that window.
No.
I've never heard of it. No, not that... Well, in 1999, you and I weren't like trawling Tooley Street, you know, touring around the bars.
No.
We've never trawled Tooley Street. Anyway, we weren't. So, it sounds bleak. I mean, it looks bleak.
Yeah.
And it's empty. Yeah. I can't imagine if you saw a picture chocolate of people, you'd go like, oh, yeah, no, of course it makes sense. It looks like it's fun. It can't be.
No.
The only thing I was going to say is like, I mean, if I'm wrong, take it out. But am I right in saying that it's not gin martinis that James Bond
vodka
drinks?
Martinis.
Famously, it's vodka martinis.
He always says vodka martini, shaking up stuff.
He does, doesn't he? Vodka martini. So actually, this whole thing is... The nonsense goes 15 layers deep, Russ.
But I think it's because Dr. David Hutton, which is his name now, I think there's a one bit where he goes, proper martinis should be gin martinis. So he basically just dismisses...
That's the thing,
dismisses Bond, you know.
But really, they should have gone like, okay, well, that's great, Dr. David Clotten, but this is about James Bond, so you better fucking make us a vodka one right now.
Maybe nobody drinks vodka martinis these days. I don't know. Maybe that's why. Maybe...
Do you know what that might
be? She was programmed to make a cocktail called Alien Vomit, though, so I did find that out.
To be fair, there were a lot of bad drinks when we were, coming of age in bars.
That probably doesn't happen anymore, does it? That used to be a really big thing when we were at university, wasn't it? Like places selling a real range of horrible cocktails with crumbs and malt.
Horrifically coloured. Yeah. Absolutely. I don't know. I don't know if it does. I don't know. Probably not. I just don't feel like... Kids these days, Russ, they don't know they're even born, do they? I can't, you know, they don't know what it's like not to enjoy a Bailey's Creme de Menthe cocktail with Goldschlager.
They probably do shots of flaming TikTok videos. Probably what they do.
Well, here we are in Whitehall, Britain's centre of government.
Now, we can't give you the exact location of our destination for security reasons, but we are headed far below ground.
But before we get there, the suit that could make you undetectable.
And a sneak preview of some of the fantastic gadgets in the new Bond film.
Of course, security here is incredibly tight. They don't let you in here unless they want to.
But science, it seems, can make almost anything possible. Jez Nelson tries on the new stealth suit that could mean a real-life spy could slip unseen into the enemy base.
Result. You know the plot. James Bond has managed to smooth-talk himself into a fancy party being thrown by a master criminal, a multi-zillionaire with a distinctly dodgy sideline in world government extortion. At the party, there's a casino, where he delivers a couple of double entendres to a gorgeous brunette and then cleans up at roulette.
But of course, 007 goes nowhere for pleasure alone. He inevitably has business to attend to. Business which requires him to slip out unseen, create some chaos, and then return nonchalantly to the party to continue his game.
Well, the average global extortionist doesn't make it easy for your James Bond types to sneak about. Not only are there polo neck-wearing guards to avoid, but all manner of fancy cameras and surveillance equipment to hide from.
Traditional camouflage clobber is all very well for hiding in shrubbery, but for a sophisticated spy, it's rather ungainly. And anyway, when it comes to hiding from a thermal camera which detects heat rather than light, you might as well not bother. People trying to avoid detection have a fundamental problem. They're alive. We churn out around 120 watts of power, and most of that is heat. So even though you think you might be doing a good job hiding, a quick look through a thermal camera, and you might as well have a light bulb strapped to your head.
So even in pitch blackness, to a thermal camera, I stand out like a sore thumb. Not exactly the image a slick covert operative would hope for. What a real spy needs is something to foil heat-sensing cameras.
Well, here I have something that should stand James Bond in good stead when he's sneaking around the garden of a stately home. It's a stealth suit, and slipping into one of these should make the wearer much less visible. There's even a stealth helmet. And this visor may look clear, but even this is treated.
Imagine if you're watching a James Bond film and there's a whole scene of him waddling around a garden in a sleeping bag with a crash helmet on.
Probably wouldn't be as popular, would it?
No, I don't think it would be. This is rubbish. This is awful, isn't it?
No, the invention is... So Jez Nelson, who we've met before, obviously. We know all about him. And we know about his... he recently sold Something Else production, I believe,
did he?
Didn't he?
Oh,
yeah,
oh, oh.
If memory serves.
He could buy a lot of sleeping bags and crash helmets for how much he sold that, I reckon.
I'm sure he's playing the long game all along. He is at a casino in an appallingly fitting white tuxedo.
Oh, well first of all, hang on, Mark. Oh. He turns up in a BMW convertible.
Oh, yes.
It's a,
great
it's a clear night, no rain.
Yeah, no rain.
He's got the bloody roof up, hasn't he? He's got the
he's
roof
got
up.
The roof up. Yeah.
He's got a roof up.
One rule for men, another rule for women.
Exactly.
Yes.
Casual sexism. Sexism.
make a note of that.
yeah. He probably even had heaters on everything. Anyway, carry on.
Which later on he won't need. Yeah, so he's in an appalling tuxedo. And I was describing earlier about one of my bugbears is it's... So he's sitting down. He's hunched over the roulette table. And he is wearing a really cheap shirt. And it's the collar's all scrunched up. And it's kind of cut, the lapels are coming over the lapel of the jacket. And the reason it's a bugbear is because Jess can't see that, I don't think. Maybe he looked in the mirror and he didn't. It's like, again, a bit like the shoelaces. Like, did no one stop and just go, Jez, mate, let me just sort out your shirt collar for you? Especially when you're trying to play a suave, sophisticated undercover agent. And it really annoyed me. It really bloody annoyed me because it just seems lazy and just uncaring. And I don't think in general, this program is not the program it's going to be in 2 years' time, no. 3 years' time, actually 4 years' time. It's in 2003. They still care at this point, but stuff like that really bothers me. Anyway, he then goes off and he does some chaos and he dresses up in, as you rightly describe it, a sleeping bag and a bike helmet. And in theory, it's to make him thermally invisible. In practice, every time they show us
he's perfectly visible.
He is perfectly visible. Yeah. He's even forced to make to nod to that at the end when he says, making me disappear. Well, certainly less visible anyway. And I'm not even sure less visible describes how visible he is.
To give it its credit, when he shows us what the thermal camera image of him is like when he's not wearing it, he looks like a light bulb. He does look like a light bulb. He looks like a big, bald light bulb, yeah? And when he's...
Yes, he does. Yeah,
when
he's
got the crash helmet on, he doesn't.
No.
So you...
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
so
yeah,
it does do
true.
That.
Absolutely.
So the one success of it is that you could fool somebody through a thermal image camera that you weren't bald. I think that's probably... The one achievement of it. But that's about it, really, isn't it?
It's so bad. There's more to discuss. But the one thing I was thinking about is, like he was saying, that the insulation is made of metal-coated plastic.
Yeah.
And that it basically absorbs some of the heat and redirects the other. And it just dawned on me as I was watching this, is like, so Jez Nelson is slowly baking.
Yeah.
He's getting hotter and hotter and hotter as all his heat. We've seen plenty of which we've seen is now being directed back. So it's like a horrible torture. The other thing that should be noted, Russ, as both you and I did in our notes, is it is so loud. It is the noisiest thing. I mean, I'm almost tempted just to go straight to the bottom of this notes and just tick the box saying presenters speaking over loud machinery. It's that loud.
It sounds less like he's wearing clothes than he's wearing a gravel drive. That's how loud it is. It's crunching so much.
Yeah.
And all of that nylon material that's around him and all that rubbing together. Yeah. He's generating sparks. They'll be visible in the camera easily.
It's so unimpressive. The only good thing about the segment I like is he talks about how, like, James Bond needs to slink away so he can kind of enact chaos. So then he can nonchalantly step back in, having done whatever he wants to do. And he literally goes to some kind of bit of machinery, one of those kind of little small round lever handles that they have on, like, boat doors. And there's obviously a very poorly added in kind of,
like a dial readout sort of thing.
Dial readout, and it, you know, eventually it kind of points to chaos. But there's just one little glorious close-up of Jez next, you know, kind of zoomed in, pulling the handle as the dial goes left. And he's just pulling this wonderful little kind of duck face.
Yeah, no, he's really, really pouty, like he's posing for Instagram
really
or something.
Yeah.
Is that his evil face, do you think?
Like, I don't know. Or I read it as like his satisfaction that he was doing his chaos. But I guarantee if you go to at TW Audit Time on either Twitter or Instagram, you'll be seeing that image, my friends. And I will be tagging in Jez Nelson because I think he's young enough to be on either Twitter or Instagram.
Yeah, definitely. And the other thing about his presentation of this is that obviously they needed to fill time because at the beginning of this, he spends a full 1 minute and 25 seconds merely describing what happens in James Bond films. Like so he pulls up to this casino and he sits down there and he just runs through what happens in a typical James Bond film.
Yeah.
Which has no bearing on what he's about to talk about at all. Like, he could have just introduced that with, you know, sometimes James Bond needs to hide in a garden. He could do it, but he doesn't. He goes through the motions of explaining all of the different things that James Bond would do in this situation. Why is he just like to fill time? Is that all he's doing or what?
I don't know.
Also, his eyebrows are going up and down a lot, which I wonder was a tribute to Sir Rog. He felt like he needed to look suaver, so he just think, oh well, suave people move their eyebrows a lot, so I'll just do that.
Do you think he thought that? Do you think he thinks suave people move their eyebrows a lot?
Roger Moore moves his eyebrows a lot, and he's a very suave man. So I assume that, you know.
So does Stephen Colbert. I suppose he's also quite suave, isn't he? Yeah. Okay, maybe you're onto something there.
Can we come up with an on-the-fly theory here?
Oh, what, that eyebrow raising?
Think of other suave men. Do they move their eyebrows a lot? I think they do. I think they do, Mark.
Okay, think of another suave man then. Or think of another man who raises their eyebrows. And are they suave?
Oh, who raises their eyebrows?
See, you raise an eyebrow. Oh, The Rock. He raises his eyebrows, doesn't he?
Is he suave? Suave-ish.
Suave-ish? Yeah. I wouldn't say he's suave, though. But then he did it more in the when he was a wrestler, didn't he?
Brad Pitt moves both his eyebrows at the same time towards the middle. Does that count?
I don't know. I think this theory needs a bit of workshopping, Russ.
If only I'd thought of it earlier, I could have thought of some more examples to prove me right and you wrong. Anyway.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. So I'll tell you about the suit. Well, no.
Oh, yeah.
I'll tell you about
this
suit.
Well, no, because this suit is nonsense, but you just describe how it could be used for soldiers and equipment.
I suppose it could be used for soldiers to keep warm when not on missions.
And so they can always hear where they are.
Ultimately, I can't think of any application that you would need to be hired from thermal imaging other than a military application, really. So things have developed since then, as they always do. The best thing they've got on the market at the moment is something called Camo Shield. It looks much better than this in that it looks like normal, pretty much like normal military clothing. Sort of clothing that doesn't look like it makes much noise. And it's not particularly thick, and it comes in camouflage colours and all that. But it does the same job in that it hides your heat signature. And if you go on the Camo Shield website and you say, can I buy this? It says, no, you can't buy this because you're not a military organisation and you can't afford it. So it's only available to sort of big military, large military organisations who are willing to spend millions of pounds on it. However, it's still a little bit rubbish because the problem with any of these thermal hiding things is that although they're hiding your heat signature, they're not necessarily the same colour and they're not necessarily the same heat signature as the background. So they won't.
That's part of the reason he stands out. Isn't
they won't
it?
Be the same.
Yeah, because you can see the shape of them.
Won't be the same colour as the background. You still see the shape moving. Yeah. So that is why new technology only released last year. There's a new one, and they've not made a whole suit out of it yet, but they've made little, almost like sleeves of it. And it's got some sort of special secret wax inside it, which is reactive to temperature and changes temperature very quickly. And there's sensors on the outside. And what they do is they measure the ambient temperature and change the heat of the wax accordingly. So you are always the same temperature as the ambient background.
Wow.
And then
that's cool.
You disappear into the background.
Mm.
So that's the new stuff on the block.
Is it just the new stuff that they have publicly talked about?
Yes.
Obviously, there's loads of new stuff that we don't know about.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Mm. So, but obviously the problem is that thermal imaging cameras in 1999 were much crapper than thermal imaging cameras in 2021. So it's a bit of a race between the two. As to which is going to, as soon as one gets better, the other gets better. And, we have to wait until the other thing is that, won't we, to get these things tested.
whoever wins, Russ, we all lose. Jez Nelson versus the Predators, you rightly said. The other thing is, I feel like I recently saw footage of, a new US military night vision camera that is so incredible that the pitch black looks like the daytime.
Really?
Yeah. And the only reason you know it's pitch black is because it's really incredible daytime footage of people, but the sky is full of stars.
Wow.
And it's genuinely incredible. Oh, yeah. It's just it's on YouTube somewhere. And it is really, really incredible. Yeah. And, you walking around in your... sleeping bag and helmet. You're gonna. I don't care how thermally visible you are. You're gonna be seen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Unless you're motorcyclist sleepover convention.
you're very true, Russ. Yeah.
Many floors underground, and we're still going. The bunker we're headed for only really comes to life in times of national emergency.
Just like in every Bond movie. So we thought it'd be fun to send out Lindsay Fallow and ask her to see what they've dreamt up for the new movie.
You can rely on the Bond filmmakers to deliver the goods on at least two fronts for the new film. Massive and impressive sets, like Bond's fictional HQ, where M briefs Bond on the villain Reynard, courtesy of some stunning graphics. And, of course, the gadgets and kit. Chris, Chris, you're the guy who's lucky enough to get to dream up those gadgets. Where on earth do you get your ideas from?
They come from a variety of sources, really. The writers can come up with ideas, the director, we come up with ideas, the art department come up with ideas. Sometimes the ideas come from inventors who come to us with possibilities that might be of use in the film. There's no one set format for it.
In the film, you've got some fairly amazing machines, you know, the cars, the boats, all that kind of stuff. Have you got any personal favourites?
I've got two favourites. My first favourite is the helicopter with these giant saw blades underneath. I think they're wicked. They've done some wonderful things and cut through buildings and walkways and pipes, and there's not much it didn't cut through in the end, and that was a lot of fun to do. It took a long time to shoot. It was very tricky to do, but that was one of my favourites. The other favourite was the boat chase with a classic Q boat. We've got a Q boat as well as a Q car in this one, and Bond jumps into this, hurtles up the River Thames past the Houses of Parliament and all round the Docklands with its array of armaments and rockets and missiles and torpedoes and the other top secret gadgets that it's got.
You know, so when Lindsay starts walking and talking, she talks about how, like, one of the most important things in a Bond film are the gadgets, and I think that is kind of true. Though increasingly, I think they're so much more difficult to do on films, because how do you wow a public who have, like, a mobile phone that pocketed do pretty much anything?
Yeah.
But I think still, back in 1999, yeah, Bond's gadgets were really important, which is why it's so disappointing that this segment is just so disappointing. It's like the gadgets are really ropey. And actually, the worst thing is, because they're the real gadgets they use in the film, like close up, really close up, they just look so cheap.
Yes. Well, and obviously they don't work. So.
Oh, I mean, they don't work. Yeah. I mean, obviously, I'm not going to criticize the gadgets for being props, but what I mean though is, like, they just look just really cheap and nasty.
But they don't even. I don't know. I've seen when props are demonstrated, sometimes they kind of sort of function in some way. There's a bit in this where you can answer a pair of blue sunglasses.
Yeah. She says, "What are these? Try them on." And she just tries on a pair of blue sunglasses.
Yeah.
And, yeah.
I mean, yeah, I guess that's, you know, that's because none of James Bond's gadgets could possibly work, which is fair enough. But then you think, well, why is this even on the programme?
See, this is the closest we get to Australia advertisement.
Yeah.
And for the film, because it's interspersed with footage from the trailer and I assume the press clips, which bizarrely are at such a low res. I'm not wrong, I'm
almost certain that whoever put together this package got that footage from a Chinese fellow who brought them around the pub. you know they all used to do that in London. They used to come around the pub with a basket of DVDs just wrapped in cellophane.
Absolutely.
I reckon it was definitely the latest release in his local.
It was either that or they downloaded it from the internet at the highest res they could get, which is still, like, you know, really, really low. Yeah, it's really stark and striking how obviously low res the film footage is, which in theory should be a lot higher res anyway.
Bearing in mind this, the BBC advertising their film for half an hour. MGM would supply them with some bloody decent clips.
Yeah, you think they'd be bending over backwards to get, like, primo footage of a high quality onto a primetime BBC One show? And yeah, it's laughable how cheap and nasty it looks. But I don't know, maybe no one can remember the film. So anyway. We're not here to talk about the film. Yeah, this whole segment is really—it's actually quite dull.
Yeah,
and it's nowhere near as exciting as I'm sure. When they wrote down, "Hey, look, we'll get someone to talk about the new gadgets in the film," I bet you they were thinking, I'm not sure, you know, obviously they weren't thinking, like, David Llewellyn's going to turn up, but, like, they were thinking, like, oh yeah, just think of all the really great gadgets from the past. This film's going to have some absolutely fantastic ones. Mm. And really, it's just a slightly boring man in a very boring room.
Who looks like Boone.
Who looks like Boone and John Prescott. And he's talking about very boring props.
Yeah.
There's nothing terribly exciting about it.
No. It's what have they got? So they've got a watch. A watch with a light. Watch with a light in it. Mark, I've got a watch with a light on it.
Yeah, you do. Yeah.
I'm not James
Bond. You do,
Bond.
Russell. You're right. Yeah. There aren't many Omega watches that come with lights in, to be fair.
Oh, right. Okay.
But in fact, there might be none. Yeah. So he opens his suitcase and there's three versions of the same Omega Seamaster watch, One with a spinning bezel, like a saw, and then another that has a like, little hook so he can climb buildings like Batman. Yeah. You know, it's just it's fun. You know, it's fun, but it's not the most exciting thing in the world. He actually talks about what the prop he wants, which is this really exciting... When you see the clip, which is a helicopter carrying beneath it these kind of 8-meter radius spinning saw blades, you probably might even remember from the film. Like, it's hugely exciting.
Yeah, good scene.
That's not in the room.
He's
basically just talking about the bit of the film he likes.
I remember that being like a good scene in the film. Mm. And also what I liked about that was that it immediately cuts his Bond car in half, which apparently...
Yes.
Apparently the marketing department of the BMW weren't expecting to happen. But when I saw that in the cinema, I assumed that it was just some crazy, nefarious Bond villain's weapon, even though they are completely real. That's a real thing that they use in America every day.
Amazing. Doing what?
So, obviously, America being a vast place, it has things like power lines and train tracks and pipelines and all these things crisscrossing the country and going through completely deserted areas of forest. And it would be incredibly arduous for them to send blokes in. When the trees grow over, it would be arduous to send blokes in to cut the branches down.
So they just fly helicopters with these blades in a straight line.
1986, some bloke came up with the idea, I know, we'll just hang a shitload of chainsaws off the bottom of a helicopter and just fly up the thing, chopping all the branches off in one go. And that's what they do. So if you go on the internet, there's plenty of YouTube videos of it. It's very satisfying to watch just this huge sort of like 30-foot chainsaw just carving through lines of trees. But I mean, but he talks about it as if it's an invention for the film. It's not, although to be fair, the ones in the film have been made to look a bit more sort of evil. If you see the ones in real life, they're a bit more sort of
cuddly.
Yeah, they're slightly cuddlier looking chainsaws than the ones in the film.
Yeah. You bring them home to your mum.
None of the other things, they're not even meant to exist, are they? The Bond things.
You
could never make X-ray specs because obviously X-rays are incredibly dangerous. So you wouldn't want an X-ray making machine next to your head.
I suppose part of the reason it's disappointing is because as I was saying, like the gadgets aren't terribly impressive.
No. Well, actually, I could tell you about Lindsay Fallow, although that, there's not much about her, weirdly. So I don't know how...
I recognise her.
Yeah, no, I recognise her. So, I don't know how old she is because it's very hard to track her down the internet. All I know is that she lives in Littondale, Yorkshire these days.
So you know where she lives, but the hell she is.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
And she started out fronting a children's show on Disney, science show on Disney. And she reported on Tomorrow's World between 1998 and 2002. And then it said she's been a tech journalist and blogger since leaving Tomorrow's World. It was on the little sort of bio that I found of her.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't find her blog. So I don't know. Is she the world's worst blogger? Or does she blog under a different name? Or no idea. What else did I find about her? One more thing I found out about her was that she was diagnosed with Addison's disease in 2013, which is a thing that stops your adrenal glands producing hormones. And it's got some horrible symptoms, but it's treatable. So she's been treated for it, so she's okay. She's sort of advocating better tech in healthcare. But for somebody who... I found it very strange that somebody who seemingly works in the field of technology, almost impossible to find on the internet. So what...
That's quite impressive.
Does she only operate on the dark web? I don't know. I don't know how that even works. Unless I was spelling her name wrong. No, but even then Google corrected me. I don't know. It's very strange. Very strange. Oh, favourite Bond gadget?
I always loved the way the golden gun came together.
Oh, yes. Yeah, that is good. Yes.
From the different elements, you know, from the cigar box, the lighter and the pen. That I always thought was... I mean, you know, Bond always had great gadgets, but there was something about that. And actually, I think it was the way it was slowly constructed in front of you as well, I thought was really brilliant.
People slowly constructing or deconstructing guns is always enjoyable in films, isn't it?
But especially when it's just random objects and, you know, then it becomes a gun. Yeah. So that is probably my... Off the top of my head, that's probably my favourite.
Maybe.
Gadget.
Maybe Mr. Scaramanga invented the concept of Transformers. Might have done, mightn't he? They might have, Megatron might be a rip-off of the Man with the Golden Gun's gun.
Do you think Megatron has three nipples?
Absolutely. I mean, he's a machine. He needs a lot of grease in.
If you think Megatron has three nipples, why don't you email us at tomorrowsworldordertime@gmail.com?
Should we move on to the next one?
Yes.
Fuck knows how I'm going to edit this shit together.
Nearly there. We're deep beneath the streets of London, below even the deepest of the underground lines.
But before we go any further, one last look at the real world of tomorrow's special agents. Our new CTRM is finding out how robots will help the spies of the future.
The underworld of espionage and surveillance is an arms race where each side struggles to outsmart the other. For spies like Bond, clever gadgets always make the difference. Tucked away in a corner of Boston, scientists are developing a new tool to get spies wired to the enemy's actions. Helen Greener is the mastermind behind a new surveillance device that may help real spies get sound and pictures back from inside enemy territory. Bring on the robots, the new players in the spying game. Urban Robot is the king of these robots. It's the most robust and the most versatile.
The Urban Robot's the toughest robot around. It can be thrown through windows. It can crawl upstairs, take a tumble down them. We've even tossed it out of 1-2-story buildings, and it can withstand the fall.
I want to see for myself if it can sneak into places even secret agents would find hard to crack. Protected by a tough polycarbonate shell, its batteries drive three small but powerful motors guided by radio control. Agility is essential. This robot tackles all kinds of terrains thanks to its articulated tank-like tracks. Two pivoting arms provide the leverage for the robot to go up surfaces as well as along. It can negotiate small spaces and steep inclines and steps. That's all very well, but surveillance demands some really smart kit on board. Infrared sensors and sonar tell the robot when it's about to crash. Inclinometers let the robot know how steep a slope it's powering up. And a compass helps it out when it gets in a spin. For the intelligence gathering role, a microphone acts as the robot's ears and transmits sounds back to base. And crucially, an onboard camera that gives you Urban's eye view. Because it's rugged, highly mobile, and has a camera to guide it, it's ideal to send into situations of unknown danger, like a hostage rescue.
Ha ha! How the tables have turned, Mark. You sit there looking all superior about my comments about Philippa Forrester, and then suddenly Dr. Helen Greener turns up. And you go all starry-eyed and all weak at the knees.
I just find her very endearing, Russ. She warms my heart. Yeah. I think she's adorable. That's all I'd say.
She's adorable. And despite the BBC spelling her name incorrectly, they call her Dr. Helen Greener. When it's green, it's greener. She is kind of the breakout star of this episode, but I won't go into that yet.
Well,
we've not discussed, the segment.
The segment, yeah. Oh, that's exciting to know. Yeah, because this is a really good bit. This is one of the segments I was talking about earlier that I thought could fit into any episode. With the exception of the couple of times Dr. Helen references James Bond, because she's been told obviously this is part of a James Bond special. This could fit into any episode that we've seen before or after, quite happily. And again, it just feels like it's one of those technologies that this particular robot seems quite simple, but it also, to my mind, feels like it's a base for what robots have become subsequently, if you see what I mean. Maybe I'm wrong, but like, I just, you know, this feels like a proper bit. At the time, in 1999, I reckon this probably felt like a really impressive bit of kit. And interestingly, so it's presented by Anya Sitaram, who I don't really remember all that well, I have to say. I she seems familiar, but I don't really recall seeing her very often. She talks about how the robot is being tested with AI. And it feels like, in a sense, that they don't know it yet necessarily, but maybe that's the really interesting part of this whole thing. But it's entertaining. It's all set in Boston. There's a lovely bit where Anya is out and about on a normal street outside some normal shops, just playing around with this bit of military hardware, and it's really entertaining. It's really fun to watch. The only duff bit I thought was when they do the hostage rescue scene, because this is not a good example of how this robot would work, not least because it relies on the doors all being unlocked if it had taken out like a saw and, you know, cut into the door, it'd be like, oh wow, this is like a Swiss Army robot, but it doesn't. It needs the doors to be unlocked. Other than that, though, I really enjoyed this segment. I thought it was really good.
It's a good segment. It's when I first watched it. Obviously, this is 1999. Forrester is absolutely knee deep in robots on presenting robot wars on BBC2.
Yeah.
And I thought, hang on a minute, well, surely you'd send the resident robot expert over there. And I thought, oh, it's a busman's holiday, isn't it?
Busman's holiday is exactly what I was thinking, Russ. No way.
Suggested it to you. She went, no way am I going over there. I'm not going to go and look at another bloody rectangle with sodding rubber tank tracks around it. I've seen 2,000 of them by now. Yeah, so that's probably why she didn't do it. Great use of music in this, because they use the John Barry piece of music called 007, which is used in a couple of the Connery films. It's an incredibly exciting piece of music, and they accompany the vehicle going around town and all stuff like that. It makes essentially somebody using a remote controlled car around town seem a lot more important and exciting than, you know, possibly would be when they were filming it.
Very true. Yeah, very true, actually. Yeah, it's a reminder of how important music is to whip up emotion. I mean, I don't think we've spoken about the music, because obviously littered throughout all these segments are lots of different uses of various themes from James Bond. Also, some that aren't, actually, we'll talk about it later, but this is a particularly solid music choice.
Yeah.
It really works, because obviously it's bombastic and over the top, but it kind of, there's a nice irony to it, and actually it does make it seem a bit more exciting.
Would you like to know about Helen Green? I bet you would.
I would love to know.
I haven't got her phone number though, Mark, so unfortunately. So she was actually born in London. She had Hungarian parents, but she's born in London. But she moved to the US when she was only 5 years old, hence the accent, I guess. She says she got into robotics early because she went to saw Star Wars, and she saw R2-D2, and it inspired her to become a roboticist. Which I still think is probably the word, but I haven't looked it up.
Well, robot engineer, I think, is the title they give her.
Oh, really? I think roboticist sounds better.
All right.
Graduated MIT, which is presumably why they're in Boston. I think all the robot things are in Boston, aren't they? So I was thinking MIT probably has the best robot department, doesn't it?
Probably.
But she started iRobot, no relation to the Will Smith film, a robotics company.
Vacuum cleaner things.
And a couple of other of her mates from the university. Started that in 1990, and their whole plan was to make consumer robots. And she was the co-designer of the very first Roomba vacuum cleaner.
Wow.
So they made her quite a few quid off that, obviously. Still make a few quid off that. But she's been, you know, top of her class in all robotics ever since. And she's got, I mean, there's a list of her awards on Wikipedia, and it's ridiculous. And it's got things like World's Best Innovator, America's Best Leader, Global Leader of Tomorrow. Barack Obama gave her the Presidential Ambassador for Global Leadership.
She's
overachiever, doesn't really, begin to measure it. She then started a drone company. She designed one of the best drones ever or something like that.
Wow.
She actually now works as a higher advisor for the US military. She was sworn in 2018 as their highly qualified expert for robotics, autonomous systems and AI, which makes me fear that she's going to be the person that invents Skynet.
You say 2017?
2018 she's done. She
2018.
But there's plenty of TED Talks and things like that from her. And she seems like a very interesting person. But this thing here, this invention we've got here, it's called the PackBot. And it turns out, you're kind of right here, Mark, it is literally the basis of all of the general purpose commercial robots that we've seen going about doing stuff. They are all just PackBots, but just with different configurations. So the US military alone has 6,000 of the buggers, and they use them. They've been using them ever since she invented them, basically. And they use them in Afghanistan and Iraq. You know those bomb disposal ones that have the arm on them that look.
Yes, yeah,
that,
yeah.
That's just a PackBot with an arm on it. It's the same. It's exactly the same thing. It's just got an extra arm on it. So immediately after 9/11,
it's like PackBot and Cynthia had a baby together.
Yeah, exactly. Go home and make some martini. But after 9/11, they sent a load in to look for the survivors. After Fukushima, they sent a load in to check out where they only had
the sleaze skates or whatever. Yeah.
The designers assisted in the development of NASA rovers. So obviously they don't just send packages to Mars, but they've collaborated because of the expertise involved, and they've made better rovers at NASA and things like that. So yeah, she's a pretty much a global genius superstar.
Wow!
And in this she's just sitting there enthusing in a basement in a jumper at a Dutch angle.
Filmed from a high angle, so she looks tiny. Yeah, in a chunky knit jumper.
From watching this, you just think she was like almost an enthusiastic amateur, but actually she's one of the world's most powerful and dangerous women.
Well, maybe because she was belittled by the BBC. She's like, no, not happening again.
Yeah.
Every villain has an origin story, Russ.
Oh, my God. She could be a Bond villain, Mark.
Oh, my God. Yeah, she could, actually.
Yeah. Wow. There we go. You heard it here first. But looking at this, I mean, the only other thing I would say, looking at this, the Packbot, despite it being brilliant, it is kind of quaint compared to what we see these days. I was browsing the Boston Dynamics website earlier, and I'm sure, because all of Boston Dynamics videos normally go viral, so I'm sure everybody listening's seen them. But I think they are an utterly terrifying vision of the future, because what Boston Dynamics have managed to do is make their robots move like, not like robots, but like animals and humans, which makes them like really creepy to me.
Sinister.
Because they've got one called Spot, which moves like a four-legged animal, like a dog or something. And that's fine. That's kind of cute until you find out it can open doors. So you can walk up to the door, just open a door. And then you go, oh, no, I don't like that. And then the other one is the more famous one. It's called Atlas, which is the one that it's kind of like human. And then they recently, I think it's this summer, they released that video of two of them doing parkour around a gym.
Yeah.
And there's a bit where one of them, I think the worst bit is the bit where one of them vaults over a bar, and he uses the bar as if, like, just like a human would, to like lift his weight over, its weight over over the bar. Oh, God, no, we are doomed. That's it. We're doomed, Mark. We're doomed. They're going to get us.
No good can go with this.
And that's it.
At least Dr. Helen's not part of that.
No. Or is she, Mark?
Don't say that. Don't ruin this moment. The other thing about the Boston Dynamics thing is there's all that footage where they're like, there's people trying to push it over and stuff, and it just doesn't.
No, exactly.
Yeah, I don't like that one.
And it's remembering that abuse as well, Mark. It's got.
Of course it is.
They don't forget.
No. All that RAM.
Oh, my God. Yeah, no, and that's all I've got to say about these robots and Lauren Lapkus. Oh, sorry. What was her name? Helen Grenier.
That was a reference to the notes that we didn't mention in the podcast. It's interesting. It felt like we were watching the ground floor of something with that one, which is kind of one of the things we really wanted from this podcast. Was like, yeah, obviously we're going to find stuff that is utter swivel-eyed nonsense, but every now and then you get the excitement of seeing something that would have been seen for the first time that you went on to be so much more important.
And also to her credit, although I've said she sold 6,000 of them to the US military, and I mean, US military aren't the greatest bunch of lads. She didn't sell them with machine guns mounted on them. they're all used as like bomb disposal things. So they're not.
Well, that she knows.
Yeah, there's none of them like trundling around killing people. They've all, as far as we know, been used to save people's lives rather than end people's lives. So add that just in case anybody worried that, you know.
Yeah, let's not impugn her
like,
good name.
Trundling around Kabul with miniguns on them or anything like that. Yeah, so I think. Well, I mean, the whole episode has been building up to this bit, Mark. So
we should say, should we, just before we start this bit, because this is it now, guys. This is the huge climax. All throughout the other, you'd have heard it, obviously, mixed in. So there's the weird Blofeld bits that we've seen. But then the other thing is, all throughout this episode, Peter and Philippa and Peter have been teasing the fact that they are going to one of, if not the, most secret room in Britain. Mm.
So this is it. Not a movie set and not normally the kind of place that anyone gets to see. This is the British government's super bunker, capable of withstanding a nuclear blast. And this is the kind of place that even James Bond would need to show his ID to get into.
This is where the Prime Minister and his top defence and intelligence aides can consult with the world. Screens connect them with British bases all over the world, with NATO headquarters in Brussels and with Washington. This is where life and death decisions are taken.
Which is why security has to be so tight. It would take a supervillain with more powers than the fictional Blofeld to sneak in here. Wouldn't it?
Next week, we're at 8 o'clock with a survival special. We test out an avalanche safety device by burying someone alive. Can't wait till then for more tomorrow as well. Then check out our website now for James Bond Behind the Scenes.
Jesus Christ.
What a payoff.
Now, in the past, you've talked about it. I'm going to call it the perineum. It's not the perineum. What is it? The terination? No, the...
the peroration.
Peroration, there we go.
Yeah, of a speech.
And how sometimes Tomorrow's World slightly fails at doing that.
Sometimes Tomorrow's World does not plant the landing. Mm.
Like using the example of a classic damp squib, the firework doesn't quite go off. In this case, you've lit the firework and the fire brigade has turned up and hosed it at high velocity. This is like deliberate sabotage, isn't it? Making the end of their program as bad as possible.
The problem is that I texted you when I watched this episode to say that I think I know what this room is. And I think this room actually is kind of special and quite secret. But they don't give you any real sense of the scale of the operation. I mean, look, it's woefully missold. It is, it doesn't even matter what the room is or what, it's not even a room, by the way. This place is much bigger than a room. It's not even what it is that you see at the end. It's the way that they absolutely horrifically oversell it and then underexplain it. And because they drip feed it throughout the episode, it's just a bit of cheap theatre. Whereas like, if they're taking all that time and explain that they have gone to, here's James Bond related stuff. You know, James Bond does this, that, and the other. But here's the reality. We are actually in one of these spaces that you know, the government makes huge, incredible decisions based on the kind of information that, you know, our intelligence agencies come up with. And we've been given pretty exclusive access. And we're going to give you a tiny tour to get a sense of power of Britain's a small country, a small European country. But with the power of our intelligence agencies and our military, it's able to have so much influence. No. They show you a boardroom that looks hugely unimpressive.
Yeah, I mean,
without that context,
I've been in nicer, like,
yeah, of course you have.
I've been in nicer
conference suites airport hotel or something like that. Yeah, absolutely.
A rare last minute entry for the worst furniture award. Those office chairs in there, they looked awful. I was just looking at them in that clip there. I was thinking, I don't like looking at sitting on those. They look well cheap.
No, they don't look comfortable, do they? Yeah. I mean, I have to say, like, you know, as someone who used to work in Whitehall in central government, I've been into plenty government departments, very poor government department boardrooms. This is par for the course. I think this is much more interesting and exciting. But I don't think anyone who watched this at the time, or indeed you or anyone who's listening to it, would get any sense of how incredible their access is to this particular place.
There is zero excitement. The only way this would be exciting is if you're excited by the idea of seeing something that you're not allowed to see, even though the thing that you're not allowed to see has no interest. Literally, the concept of not being able to see something is enough.
Yeah.
Like... But no one, you know, you have to have something the other side of it. You have to have some sort of surprise or benefit to seeing this secret. Otherwise, it's going to be disappointing, isn't it? It's baffling.
It would be less disappointing if they hadn't trailed it throughout the entire episode as being something special. Now, two things. I'd say, by the way, Britain's most secure secret place is somewhere Tomorrow's World are not going to be turning up to film. Right. So this is already, you guarantee, this is not the most secure. It's a really interesting place.
I'm telling you, Mark, Queen's Toilet. It's Queen's Toilet.
And that's what I was going to say. And then the other thing is, actually, the room you may want to see more than any other is somewhere like the Queen's Toilet. Like a place that you know exists that, you know, no one's ever filmed. And not when she's in there, obviously. Leave the poor woman alone. So I believe this is a place called Pinder, which is a military bunker, for just the word they use, that's under...
I always like it when they're referring to these things. They always call them citadels, don't they? I always like that.
It always gives them
a romantic imagery, even though when actually you see footage of it, it's just a load of concrete tunnels.
Yeah, exactly what it is. And though luckily, actually, thanks to Pinder, sometimes I think some people mistakenly referred to as Q Whitehall. We are able to tick another box later on in the TW tropes, but we'll get there. You know, so Pinder is the real kind of situation. So obviously, you know, the famous space is Cobra, you know, Cabinet Office briefing room may. Oh, well, you know, they're going to Cobra, so it must be serious. But the reality
classic
is it's places like Pinder. Yeah, absolutely. It's places like Pinder that are the real places that are the real kind of, you know, the British equivalent of the Situation Rooms. There's also a great thing where it's like, I literally don't know where it is, but because it's a military bunker in Whitehall, it's almost certainly underneath the Ministry of Defence. Mm. And in one of the clips in the earlier segments, as I said to you, they say, well, you know, we're here now, we can't tell you where we are. They're literally parked outside the Ministry of Defence. I mean, literally parked outside the Ministry of Defence.
On double yellow lines,
yeah. And as having worked at the Home Office, when somebody did mistakenly park outside the Home Office in double yellow lines for more than 15 minutes, that was treated as a bomb attack. And that car was smashed into and removed. they really don't take things lightly. Now, this is a pre 9/11 era, but even then, you know, they were definitely clearing off cars from double yellow lines. It's so disappointing. It's so disheartening because, like, this could have been really something special, and it isn't. It is devoid of all. What a way to finish the program, especially after the really enjoyable robotic segment that came before.
Did we explain the gag at the end?
Oh, and that's the other thing. You're absolutely right. No, we didn't. So we were joking earlier that the whole Blofeld interstitial linking or the overarching linking process has a real great payoff. It doesn't. The whole gag at the end is that, oh, this is so secret, no one can get in here. And sure enough, that, you know, they try and pretend that the cat has snuck in, which means that Blofeld isn't. Oh, it's just, Russell, it's awful. It's just so, I mean, I can't even bother to explain,
like,
it properly.
Cat sneaks through door, immediate cut to credits.
Immediate cut, yeah, nothing.
As if, like,
it's awful.
You know, the nation's Tomorrow's World Watchers were just sitting there roaring in their armchairs at this unexpected ending. It's so strange.
I wonder,
the only explanation, right, in order to try and give some credits where it's possibly not due, perhaps whoever owns Pindar, the MOD, had agreed something a bit more juicy and then had pulled out at the last minute. But the Tomorrow's World crew had already organised everything and it was a bit too last minute, so they had to go through with it. So they couldn't show whatever the thing was that they thought they were going to be allowed to show. So it would have been more of a denouement than expected, than actually what turned up. You know what I mean?
I do, but the thing is, like, for a couple of segments before, when they arrive outside the MOD halfway through the program, and then we see them walking through a corridor, and then we see them going through the capsule doors,
yeah,
which are always fun to use, and then they're walking down a corridor. So it's like they had access to more than just the boardroom. Now, the boardroom area is where the Prime Minister sits and makes big decisions. But I shared with you a link to, there was, because I remember reading it years ago, that the MOD let in an artist to take photographs to record Pinder for a sequence of works he's doing. And that's the thing about government stuff like this. Like, if you have a really interesting project, that they're often, you'd be surprised, sometimes they will say yes. And he recorded photos of inside Pinder that are digitally corrected to make sure that they kind of hide certain things. And if you click on that link, like, yeah, you see the orange chairs in the boardroom, so it is Pinder. But then you also see things like where people slept and the broadcast studio they had set up. Like, and as I said, like, that gives you more of the idea that there really is this kind of big bunker under Whitehall, which is right in the middle of the city, has all these tube lines running through it and stuff like this, you know. So even the mere project of constructing this place must have been incredible. Like, you can't just build a nuclear bunker in the middle of Whitehall.
Were there lorry loads of mysterious exactly. Lorry loads of gravel, just not gravel, like,
well,
like,
I think it happened in the late 80s, early 90s.
Well,
I don't know, maybe,
according to my thing, it took 10 years to build and it opened in 1992. Yeah. So surely throughout the 80s, there was just like lorry loads of soil being...
You're absolutely right. There must be. Yeah. But they probably hid it somewhere. I don't mean hid it in like... it's probably just a home
just
brand.
The
like
greatest,
British
the greatest
gas.
Escape. Like, they hid it in people's...
Yeah, just shaking out their trouser legs. Yeah. Yeah, it's like, you know, like, that's what I mean. I think there's a lot there that's really exciting and interesting, but they don't give you anything really to explain what it is. They literally just say, we're in the secret room, have a great time, and next week it's a survival special.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's actually quite infuriating. And we could easily talk ourselves up into a real froth. Because actually, it's a really fun, enjoyable show. Mm. And then they just sort of kind of just give up.
Yeah. My only piece of research, apart from that little fact about it being finished in 1992, do you know why it's called Pindar?
I mean, I assume it stands for something.
No.
Oh, no, I don't then.
So there's an ancient Greek poet called Pindar.
Oh, right. Okay.
And when Thebes was razed to the ground in 335 BC.
Thebes?
Yeah. His house was the only one left standing.
Oh.
So there you go. It's a little suggestion.
That's a nice.
I guess it's a little suggestion that once we all get.
It's an illusion.
Yeah, once we all get nuked, they'll all still be sitting pretty.
Yeah. I love stuff like that. That's brilliant. What a great name. You love it when smart people come up with interesting names of places that you've never heard of.
Exactly.
Oh, very good. See, I mean, look, we've done more justice to Pindar than Tomorrow's World did. And we have zero access.
Yeah, and that's it.
What an episode. It was mostly good.
Yeah.
Just a shame. It's interesting how many episodes. Well, I know this is an order time, but we audit episodes individually, and then we have these. The idea of the TW tropes at the end, these Tomorrow's World tropes, is to work out, you know, what kind of crutches does the program rely on to kind of keep it going. I'm worried now. We've seen a bit too many that just can't plant the landing, because it would have been so easy to put like a segment, the robotic segment at the end, and go like, oh, that's a really solid bit of stuff. Put that at the end, and that would have been great. Yeah. And actually, if they'd gone to Pindar and said, oh, by the way, here we are in actually the most secret place, or, you know, one of the most secure places in British government, but without trailing it, it would have been like, oh, what a fun way of ending. But they don't. It's the fact that they bloody fucking trail this place throughout the entire episode that it has to pay off, and it just doesn't.
No, not at all. No.
That's what I find infuriating.
You've got this whole sort of, however many films it was then, 20 films probably back then, or however, 18 films, back catalogue.
Yeah, 18
sounds right,
famous
moments.
Yeah.
And things that they could possibly pastiche
or pay
homage to.
Yeah.
There's any number of little joke endings they could have done. Not that I can think of any at the moment, apart from...
Well, they could have finished Casino.
...see dressed as Ursula Andress, but...
that's pretty much your waking day, isn't it? No, but like they could have saved the Casino. Like Peter Snow could have been in a tux in a Casino, and Philippa Forrester in a lovely ball gown.
Yeah.
Lovely, you know, dressed to the nines, and they could have been drinking martinis, you know, and that's how they sign off.
Yeah.
That would have been a bit of fun, actually. You're right.
Yeah. He could have called himself Dr. Snow.
Oh, look, this shit writes itself.
It really does. So why do they find it so difficult?
I don't know. I find it so... Well, I mean, except that obviously in the last episode we were talking about, which is the 500th episode special that they did, and you worked out there's an episode every 9 days.
Yeah.
I don't think there's an episode every 9 days now. I'm sure if we check, it probably it's slowed down somewhat. It was probably much more seasonal than annual. But if you are producing that much content, you're not going to be able to plant the landing every single time. So maybe we're just unlucky. But it just seems to me obvious that like you can just shift a couple of things around. Like if you have the Jez Nelson thermal invisibility segment and you follow that with the gadgets, which just doesn't quite work. I'm sure you wanted it to work, but it doesn't quite work. Then, you know, you kind of bury that in the middle and then put some of the stronger stuff at the end. But to finish in this bunker thing, I don't know, just they don't do justice.
I'm going to make a proposal, Mark, that we add another thing to the checklist.
Oh, yeah.
Tomorrow's World ends on a damp squib.
Okay, I'm adding it now, and I'll make sure I add it to the master list as well. Episode ends on damp squib. Right, done. We're up to 13 of these things.
Excellent.
Now.
All right.
Speaking of which, Russ, shall we?
Yes, Mark. Are you? What's that small thing you're pulling out of your shoe? Is that a miniaturized top secret laser ledger? Oh, it's expanding to full size magically.
Oh, here it is, Russ. I found it. It didn't come out of my shoe, obviously, because that would be ridiculous. There it is. Right. Tell you what, why don't you tell everyone about 1999?
Oh, yeah, can do. I mean, I should be able to conjure up from memory because it's, you know.
I know. It's a year we should be familiar with.
What are we going to do first? Costages?
I think costages, if you like, yeah. Normally, how much were people earning and how much is the house? Let's start with the big things first, and then we can boil down.
Hoos is £104,000 in London.
Amazing.
Half price to what it is today. The old salary, 16 grand. Car, 12 grand. Your favourite, litre of petrol, 77 mm-hmm. pence. I remember paying 77 pence for a litre of petrol.
Which is about, what, £1.10?
£1.23 today, so, yeah.
£1.23, yeah. Bang on. And milk?
The old milky. £1.36.
Unbelievable. Honestly, at some point, I mean, I'm now determined that we keep this podcast going so we can find the inflection point when milk became a reasonably priced commodity and not this horrifically expensive.
It's starting to make me worry that this site...
White gold.
It's starting to make me worry that this site that I get this milk fact off every week...
Oh, you think it might be off?
Exactly. Maybe they're basing on the price of some sort of premium milk that we're not aware of.
Well, can you do me a favour?
Platinum top.
I'm very happy for you to use the same site for everything else, but can you double source milk prices from now on?
Yeah, I will absolutely fact check the milk department next time.
Thank you so much. Did you look at the Argos catalogue? How much is a Russell Hobb anything?
Hang on. I haven't given you a pint of beer yet.
Oh, a pint of beer, yeah, so sorry.
£1.95. That seems expensive. I reckon I could...
That seems quite a lot, actually.
I pay £1.95 a pint of beer now.
Yeah, that seems quite pricey.
Although, yeah, I mean, I suppose there weren't as many Wetherspoons around back then.
Look, this is about the time you and I would... what was the withdrawal of champions? Was it £20 or was it... No, it was 10, wasn't it? Like, you'd have a night out on £10, basically.
Well, I remember that the Wetherspoons beer and burger was £2.99, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And that's when they used it wasn't even a cow that they used, was it? Was it a zebu? Is that what it's called? It was some sort of exotic animal.
It was.
That's amazing. You never get away with that these days, would you? Although maybe, I mean, after Brexit, maybe the zebus will make a comeback. There'll be fields of them across Britain.
Tasty zebu. Yeah.
Sounds like something a Scientologist would eat. So what do you want first? Do you want the charts or do you want the Argos catalogue?
Oh, Argos catalogue first, yeah, definitely.
Okay, well, I was absolutely disgusted when I looked at this Argos catalogue, Mark.
Oh, okay.
I'll tell you why. Because Russell Hobbs is no longer the most expensive catalogue.
Oh.
Those eggheads at Tfal have turned up with a kettle that is a, which is, hang on, £5. Five full pounds. So the Russell Hobbs Millennium White Cordless Filter Kettle is £34.99. Tfal have swooped in with the Tfal Vitesse Gold High Speed Cordless Filter Kettle.
Oh, wow. That does sound, to be fair, it does sound better. Well, what colour is it?
The words Vitesse and Gold in it. That's a problem, isn't it?
Yeah.
They're bringing all that French, bloody fancy French bloody language in there, making it sound more expensive. It has got some nice features, though, I've got to say.
I'm listening. Maximum. You do look at, you have a smiley
maximum
face.
Maximum capacity, 1.7 litres.
Okay.
It's got a hinged locking lid.
Ooh.
This is the bit. This is where the money comes in. It's got a gold-plated high-speed element. I didn't know that was even a thing you have.
No.
Rapid boil element technology, removable washable scale filter, twin water level windows, 360-degree rotational base, neon power indicator, cord storage, non-slip feet, 3,000 watts. Yours for £39.50.
It sounds great. To be fair, it does sound better than the white Millennium Russell Hobbs monstrosity.
All right, calm down, Mark, calm down. We'll be back next time, don't worry.
Cinema box office?
Right. So number 10, we're starting immediately with a title that I can't pronounce.
Oh, brilliant.
It's either Onegin, 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 Onegin.
I think it's Onegin. Onegin, yeah. Right. I think it's Onegin.
It's got a couple of the Fines. Well, it's directed by Martha Fines. It's got Ralph Fines in it. Toby Stevens, I like him. And Liv Tyler. No idea what that is. Never heard of it. Hasn't even got a press picture.
Yeah.
Number 9. I don't remember. It's called Random Hearts. It's got Harrison Ford in it.
Oh, that does ring a bell, but not enough.
8. Ed TV, which I remember.
Oh,
was a bit
TV.
Slaughtered by the
God,
fact
yeah.
it came out after...
it did. It was
Truman
a poor man's
show,
Truman Show. Yeah.
Number 7, The Blair Witch Project.
Ah.
Which I never understood the appeal of.
It's not that good.
No, it's not very good.
It was fun, but yeah.
But I feel like it's Americans never saw Ghost Watch. So.
Well, no, they didn't.
No, they didn't.
So compared
to Ghost Watch, it's absolute nonsense. Like, Ghost Watch is genuinely terrifying. Blair Witch Project is shit compared to Ghost Watch.
I remember myself and my friend Jackie, we went to a 24 or 48 hour film festival at the Prince Charles Cinema in London. Actually, it must have been 48 hours because we definitely... And there were film... Basically, you'd book a seat and there were films projected for 48 hours.
Yeah.
And the big selling point was it was going to be one of the first showings of the Blair Witch Project in Britain. So that was... Everyone was hyped for that. But then... Actually, The other film that was sort of an exclusive that was shown the following night was The Sixth Sense, and that was so much better.
Yeah.
And it was genuine. It wasn't a horror per se, but like actually it wasn't a horror film festival because it was first time I saw like Goodfellas projected and a few other things like that. And I don't know, Emmanuel in Africa, I just seem to remember being one of them as well, with a James Bond. Ah. Of course. What's his name?
Lazenby?
What is his name? Yeah, it was George Lazenby. George Lazenby is speaking to Emmanuel on a flight and she regales him with all these stories of her activities in Africa. Anyway, Blair Witch was a real letdown, probably because it was so overhyped. But yeah, it's not Ghostwatch.
Number six, American Pie.
Wow, okay. I remember seeing that at university, yeah.
I maintain that Stifler is a really, really funny character. Probably typecast, but I can't imagine being anything else. But I still think he's a very, very funny character. Number five, Tarzan. The Disney one.
Yeah.
Which you'd think I'd be a fan of because I like Phil Collins, but Phil Collins I don't listen to after 1991, so not interested. Number four, Fight Club.
Oh, yeah.
Number three, East is East.
Okay.
Number two, the aforementioned Sixth Sense.
Yeah.
And number one, bearing in mind this is 2 days after Tomorrow's World, The World Is Not Enough.
Oh, must have been preview screenings then, yeah?
Well.
Because they said it was released next week.
Well, it's number one at the box office.
Well, there you go. More BBC lies.
Yeah. But I was just wondering how much of a, you know, TW bounce that this got, you know. You know, would it have been at number one if it hadn't featured so heavily on Tomorrow's World?
I doubt it. That Peter Snow bounce all the kids really want to get.
Yeah. So, and I also, there's one thing about The World Is Not Enough that I've forgotten about. It's directed by Michael Apted. The Seven Up series.
Yeah, yeah. No longer with us,
unfortunately. That's a strange little thing, isn't it?
It is, isn't it? Yeah. I knew he directed one. I wouldn't have been able to tell you which one because obviously I don't remember it. The World Is Not Enough. Chop, pop chop.
Here we go. We've got it. Right. I remember most of these. I wouldn't necessarily listen to them all. Number 10, Waiting for Tonight, Jennifer Lopez. Number 9, What I Am, Tin Tin Out, featuring Emma Bunton.
Oh, yeah.
Number 8, Turn by Travis.
Yeah.
Number 7, The Inescapable, I Try by Macy Gray.
Wow.
Number 6, Keep On Moving by Five, which I think might be the best Five song, actually, if you're going to pick a good Five song.
I'm not going to.
Number 5, If I Could Turn Back the Hands of Time by R. Kelly.
Mm.
It's impossible to say R. Kelly without thinking you're...
Telling it all then. Yeah.
Number 4, Lift Me Up by Jerry Halliwell.
Mm-hmm.
Number 3 is a new entry, which is the one song in this I don't recognise. Every Time, Stroke, Ready or Not by the boy band A1. Number 2, Will 2K by Will Smith. Do you think he'll ever release any more rap records from Will Smith? Do you reckon that's even done these days?
No, I think he will.
It's about time he released a new one, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, he's got that new film coming out, King Richard, so I'm expecting some kind of end credits rap about the Williams sisters.
Oh, yeah. He actually could do, do you remember that in the 1980s, there was that, I think it was called The Brat, and he was a fake version of John McEnroe who released a rap song.
I do, yeah.
Will Smith could do his own version of that, but for the Williams sisters.
Yeah, he could, yeah.
Number 1, Robbie Williams, She's the One, Stroke, It's Only Us.
Okay.
Yes, that's the pop charts. Marcus.
Brilliant. It does remind me of being alive in 1999. It does, yeah. It's difficult not to...
Mid-range, middle of the road. Nothing too exciting.
Yeah, not really great, is it? Mm. Well, let's do this, Russ. Let's order this, right? So, most important invention.
Well, it's the robot. It's the robot.
Full stop, isn't it? Sorry, Russell, are you mocking my friend Dr. Helen?
It's the robot. My little excited robot.
That's not her. I suppose it's not her. She sounds like it. Okay. Most worthless invention.
Oh, hello. I'll just have to quickly scan back through to all the use.
Yeah, no, that's exactly what I'm doing as well. Bearing in mind, obviously, and I say this every episode, invention is a loose term.
Yeah. Hang
on.
I think maybe Cynthia's cocktail bar.
Oh, wow. I was thinking the spy equipment or the thermal invisibility suit. Just because, like, I don't know. I suppose like it has. Cynthia's cocktail bar is not a bad shout.
I will discount the thermal invisibility suit on the grounds that it was a
concept.
Further developed that went on to something better.
Yeah, fair.
Now, I would say with the spy equipment, it was rubbish, but people at least got some sort of enjoyment out of it because it was obviously a very successful business at the time.
At least for another 18 years.
Well, maybe not even enjoyment. They maybe, you know, fucked over their business partners and spouses or whatever. Whereas the cocktail bar, it appears that it created misery for everyone involved in that all of the customers found it a horrible experience. And even
as the only evidence we can find of his existence is people suffering. Yeah.
And Cynthia herself just had a look of sadness in her eyes as she stood there.
Yeah, okay. All right. I'm happy with that. Yeah. Most of Russ's invention is Cynthia's, even the name alone. It's like by the time Cyber Bar came out, it's like, surely it was dated even then.
Do you think Cyber is going to make a
comeback
at some point?
Oh, yeah. Will Smith's going to rap about it soon, Russ. Most inaccurate prediction of the future.
Oh.
I'm sorry. I have one. Which is the way they teased the last segment throughout the entire episode.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, blatantly. Yeah, yeah. The idea that the end of the episode will be in any way
exciting or interesting
or worth watching. Totally. That's absolutely it. Yeah.
Yeah. Because the rest of it's fair, isn't it? Yeah, the rest of it's fair. Worst screw up by a presenter?
Mm.
Oh, Peter Snow's shoelace.
Oh, yes. Yeah, yeah. Well, genuinely. Snow's shoelaces, Nelson's collar.
Nelson's collar. I think the shoelace is more egregious in the sense that Nelson doesn't know his collar's riding up, right?
Yeah.
He needs other people to point that out to him. Whereas, like, I know I was joking about Peter Snow earlier, but it's like, you know you've tied your shoelace or not, and you know when it's undone.
Yeah.
Okay. Because actually, the rest of it, like all the presenting was really decent. You know, it was all pretty good quality. I did find Peter's response to the questions to whether he wants cigarettes strangely aggressive.
Yeah.
And it's almost like, Peter, you know this is a bit. You know that he's not really offering you. Like, it was strangely aggressive.
Maybe he's only just given up when, you know, he didn't want to be.
I think maybe he's given up, but he's doing it on the sly and he wants his wife to think that he's definitely not doing
it. He wanted John to not think that he'd.
Yes.
Yeah. Obviously, John.
He's a social smoker.
John being over on Channel 4 has probably got like spliffs.
Doobies, yeah. Best attempt at making something boring interesting.
Well, once again, I think it's probably them trying to make the end segment interesting by making it seem...
Oh, the Blofeld nonsense? Oh.
I know you don't want to, but that is clearly what they did. It, surely.
God, it might be. Yeah, I mean, it could be. I mean, the other thing I was thinking was the whole Jez Nelson in a casino, when really he's walking around a house in Richmond in a sleeping bag.
Is that 1.5 minute like rundown of what a James Bond film to make us think of James Bond films so that it's less
so he doesn't look like he's in a sleeping bag. Yeah, I do. Yeah. I think there's much more heavy lifting in that than there is the Blofeld thing.
I mean, let's give it to him because he's not going to win anything else, is he? So,
No. Win. Yeah. Okay. Best use of music. Right. Now, this is a serious discussion.
This is serious stuff here.
Yeah.
I mean, I hope you've got the list written down here, Mark.
I do. Well, like, I've added in to each segment in green, I've added in the tunes used. So if you go back over the notes, you'll see it.
No, right. Okay. So, well, it can't be a James Bond theme because that's too boring a choice.
No, agreed.
Backpack Helicopter has got three of my favourites. I'm going to ignore the David Arnold part of it.
See, I can't agree with you. I don't think you can ignore it.
Really? I tell
you why, because they could have used the non-David Arnold, but Shaken and Stir. So David Arnold had an album out in 97, Shaken Not Stir, which I think is most famous for the On Her Majesty's Secret Service by Propellerheads. But there's a few others that are relatively well known, and they use three tracks in total.
But
they deliberately picked that album. But, they didn't pick the original soundtrack, they picked that album.
It might well have been cheaper, but the...
BBC Player Flat
the,
Free.
The Space Mark part that he plays is just
brilliant. I love
it's not the David Arnold Space March, it's just the John Barry.
No, it is. I checked,
but it sounds identical.
Oh, yeah.
What I mean is
I see what you're saying
is that there's if you heard the two next to each other, you wouldn't, there's no extra bits to that bit.
What there's drums. There's kind of a loud, yeah. But just that's it, though. It literally is one tiny change, which kind of makes it all the more egregious that they use the David Arnold. Forgive me. I'm not trying to make you not choose it. Because here's the thing. If Space March...
For me...
The John Barry version was on there.
For me, it's a toss-up between Space March or 007, yeah. I'm going to say.
I want to say Space March. But secretly, I want to pick It's
Space March. I fucking knew you were going to say that.
Yeah.
Knew you were going to say that.
Yeah, well, I really like that film and I really like that tune. And it's, I also like the fact that they, I don't know whether, so this is in the Jez Nelson thermal invisibility segment. When he leaves the casino, he steps outside, they have the Ipcress Files music. And as I said to you, it's like the Ipcress File is brilliant. It's another John Barry classic. But famously, the one thing the Ipcress File is not is James Bond. It was deliberately designed not to be, you know, Harry Palmer is not James Bond. He's a really boring civil servant.
But it is great stepping outside a building music.
It is great. It is really well used.
Loads of times in the Ipcress File, you see him just sort of stepping outside of a building. And that's exactly what he does there.
Proper spy work. Yeah, it's proper spy work. Harry Palmer does proper... So I do want to use that because I just really like that music. And I think it's really well used. But I think that it feels like it's going against the spirit of the programme. I also like Blofeld's Laser, actually. But I think I'll go with Space March.
Yeah.
And part of the reason is because one of the reasons I was talking you out of it is because I just wish they'd used the original. And I'm slightly annoyed that they used the David Arnold version. But that is such a brilliant piece of music. And I have to say, I've been humming it for days.
Yeah.
Exactly, yeah.
I love it.
Okay, good. We're settling that. It was good that we agreed. Best or worst use of furniture?
So I wasn't keeping my eyes peeled for furniture. And it
wasn't a lot.
I think maybe the board remote was the only... I'm trying to think. Any other places with furniture? Hang on, let's think about this.
Everyone's standing up, pretty much. Well, Jez Nelson sits down at the roulette table.
What was Boone showing his wares on?
A table.
Just a table.
Which is a boring table.
Nothing
boring or good.
Poker chips count as furniture because those poker chips in Jez Nelson's casino were rubbish.
They look really cheap, didn't they?
Well, I guess it's got to be the office chairs.
It's got to be.
While we were talking about this, but you did mention it in the notes. There's a bit where they're walking down a corridor, and there's these paintings on the wall, incongruous paintings.
So they're walking through this really utility-laden corridor on their way to the border of Pinder, and they must be, you know, tens of meters underground, and there are these horrifically anemic watercolor, like 1980s, 1990s, but bland, insipid watercolors in gold frames.
I'd say too boring for a dentist's waiting room. Like, super boring.
Awful. Really appalling. And there they are hanging. And the interesting thing is, at the link to the artist's page, his photos of Pinder, he has taken a picture of one of those pictures. Even he is an artist who was inspired. Because it's horrible.
I think if it's not a work of art and it's just there to decorate a wall, I'm calling that furniture.
Okay, I'll go with that because it's awful. Mm. Brilliant. Did we see anything this episode that made it through to the future? Well, the robot.
Wobots.
The robot. Yeah. don't be mean to her, Russ. And James Bond, I suppose, as well. The robots absolutely is exactly why we asked that question, because that has totally made it through. And what does this episode tell us about the 11th of November, not the 11th, the 17th of November, 1999?
Well, it tells us that James Bond's coming out this week.
That's a bit of a tough one, isn't it? Because it's a special episode.
It's refreshingly free of millennium nonsense, which is good. Yeah. So
I think both you and I were expecting something, but we didn't get it.
The fact that they're doing that nonsense with those walkie-talkies shows us that mobile phones aren't really cutting through much currently.
No, I mean, we see when Philippa is in the cocktail bar, Cynthia's cyber bar, we see her mobile phone because it's rung by Peter. And
it's a Motorola clamshell.
It's a little Motorola clamshell. Yeah, it's just a phone. I'm sure she can text on it, but that's probably about it. The other thing is, in the episode from 1996, we were tripping over Dutch angles and the use of colored gels on every background of every wall in every non-studio-based segment.
Yeah, we've gone through that mostly,
We've gone through that mostly. Talk about that in a second. This is a much more maturely made program, or maybe it's got out of that kind of weird 90s fetish for chaotic imagery.
Yeah.
With the exception of the kind of the fake computer software, whatever you call it.
Yeah, that sort of framing thing.
But ultimately, this tells us more about James Bond than I think it does 1999.
Yeah, but no, I absolutely agree. They seem more straightforward generally and less gimmicky than the 1996 episode. There was no...
Yeah.
It just seemed like a straightforward episode of Tomorrow's World that happened to be in 1999, even though it was themed, but the way it was filmed and the way it went together. Whereas the 1996 one had all those weird fonts as well. And all that
True. I forgot about that.
It seemed like it was filmed by a lunatic. Whereas this one was very straightforward and I think it's probably why, you know, it was quite a pleasant surprise, because you would imagine that maybe they would have just taken that even further. But clearly, whatever drugs they'd been taking in the early 90s worn off by now, and they were all fine again.
Yeah, we're only 11 episodes in, we're not quite ready to codify our grand theory of Tomorrow's World. But interestingly, at the moment, it looks like this might be a weird, you know, as much as, you know, you're not a huge fan of Peter Snow, perhaps this period kind of marks this kind of the eye of the storm between the kind of the word-fueled chaos of the mid to late 90s. Yeah. And what's to come.
and actually,
this has so much more in common with the episodes we saw from the early 90s.
Definitely,
just a bit more, like, in a sense, you know, as partly the presenting style, which is a credit to Philippa and Peter. Mm. It's like, mostly Philippa, they are letting the experts do the talking, and they are letting the objects they're discussing do the talking.
Yeah.
And, you know, and they're not really trying to zhuzz it up. The only zhuzzing up here is because there's a Bond brief.
Absolutely. Yeah.
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 It was a good episode. Enjoyable. That's the end of the order, Russ.
Well, no.
And I think it's come through with mostly flying colours.
Hang on a minute, Mark.
Well, that's the end of the order, but I think the TW tropes, I actually don't label as the order for some reason.
Oh, you got a separate label for those, have you?
I call it TW tropes. So we do have to do our checklist then. I have removed two because they're irrelevant.
Yeah.
So let's talk about the ones that could be relevant. So presenter having to speak over loud noises. Now, the Jez Nelson joke aside, literally at the beginning of the first segment, the helicopter backpack, she's screaming over the... So I think that's a tick. And Stanley Kubrick reference, I really do feel... I feel comfortable that the Nirvana baby in the gas globe is a reference to the Star Child. My only concern is that every time we watch an episode from this era with those opening credits, we'll be ticking this box.
Okay, we're only allowed to use it once then. Let's make an agreement. Allowed to use it once.
Thank you. That's exactly what I'm going to suggest. So that is absolutely perfect. Something to do with oil rigs? No, nothing. I can't believe
you say that, Mark.
Are you thinking what I'm thinking? Is that oil rigs or is that oil pipes?
Well, yeah, I was going to say that those giant helicopter things. Well, what is not enough is about oil pipes, and that giant helicopter thing is cutting through oil pipes, which are connected to oil rigs. Shall I look at the plot of The World Is Not Enough?
Yeah, go on then. If there's an oil rig on there, we're ticking it. How about that?
If it was any other Bond film, I'd remember it. It's like there's some sort of
history.
It has a memory wiping power. The film's...
God, wouldn't it be amazing if that was the plot?
Here we go. The film's plot revolves around the assassination of billionaire Sir Robert King by the terrorist Renard. Blah, 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 Electra, blah, 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 blah. During his assignment, Bond unravels a scheme to increase petroleum prices by triggering a nuclear meltdown in the waters of Istanbul. What do you reckon, Mark?
Yeah, go on. Suspiciously obvious brand name on the ad-free BBC.
Well, the film The World Is Not Enough.
I think so too. Clear and blatant lying.
Legend has it that this clear and blatant lying. This easily checkable novel.
Evil farmers? There's no evil farmers.
No.
Are there any evil farmers in the film?
No. I was just trying to think. I was just trying to think. No, it didn't make any sense. I was running through it. I was just trying to get a bingo here, Mark. That's all I'm trying to do.
No. It's not going to be this episode, unfortunately. Casual sexism. Now, I know you were joking about the roof up and the roof down, but actually, in general, I don't think there is any.
Do you not think the roof up, roof down thing is casual sexism?
No. Oh. Sorry. Lab filled with darkness and coloured lights. Now, lab, if we replace that with corridor, then yes, definitely. Yeah. Because when they go into Pinder, they've absolutely got some blue lights flashing through. Yeah. So I think a lab is space. I might even change it to space field.
Yeah, you change it to interview area or something similar.
Background filled with darkness and coloured lights. Dutch angle, yep. You're damn straight there is. Item presented from a gantry.
Can't think of any gantries, no.
Episode ends in a damn squib.
Yeah. Our inaugural worst one, yeah.
I know, go figure.
I reckon that one's going to be ticked plenty of times.
I hope it's not, but I fear it will.
Well, just thinking back to previous episodes, I think it's,
Luckily we don't do retrospective audits.
Well.
So that's that. That is another episode in the bank.
Lovely. I bet that was a long one. Well, Mark, that was another fantastic episode. You know what I'll say about you as a co-presenter?
Yes, Russell? No, I don't. No.
Nobody does it better.
Oh, God bless your cotton socks.
But, I hope everybody's enjoyed this. I know it's been a long one, but we've really enjoyed what we've been doing. And I presume as, podcast listeners, you've got all the time in the world. Until next time, from me and Mark, we will see you tomorrow.
Bye-bye. When we were in Ireland for a wedding back in October, just over a month ago, we were in this town just north of Dublin called Slane. It was all very nice. And myself and Josie drove to the next town to go to an ATM to get some cash to get an envelope for Alison and Richard. And as we were driving by, we saw my sister. And she was out perambulating and she had her headphones on. And so it was like, oh, Ruth. And she couldn't see us. And so I rolled down the window as we drove by. I went, like that, obviously. And she said that she was listening to an episode of Tomorrow's World all the time. And as I drove by doing this, apparently I was laughing on the podcast. Which explained her slightly shocked look.